Hello, good day, good morning, good evening, wherever you are, whatever time it is. This is James Bond Radio Podcast 116, where we're looking at part two of the Roger-spective. Sir Roger, retrospective, we salute you, Sir Roger. With me, as always, is my main man, Mr. Tom Sears. How are you, my friend?
I'm doing very well. I love that little introduction. I loved how smoothly you delivered that. That was brilliant. Well done, man.
That was as smooth as Roger himself, wasn't it?
It was indeed, absolutely. So, how you been? What have you been up to? Anything exciting?
Nothing exciting, no. I've just been a hermit, Tom.
What is exciting is sitting down and choosing our favourite Roger moments for the Roger-spective part two. That's exciting in itself. So, yeah, I'm up for some of that action today.
I tell you what, it's exciting, but it's also kind of difficult because you could almost list so many scenes that would be here for 10 hours. But, you know, you've got to... Like we said before, when you've got to try and pick just one or two things, it does get tricky, but it's so cool because we've got, I mean, I'm really looking forward to just basically going through everything.
Yeah.
So many different sort of scenes and lines. And so what are we going to be looking at, just to give the listeners a brief?
To give you all a little heads up on what you're into today, we're looking at the best Sir Roger deadly situations. We're looking at the best fist fights. We're looking at the best chase scenes. We're looking at just the coolest moments. I already know one of them from Octopussy that immediately comes to mind. I know you know that one too. We did with Sir Sean, we're looking at the Bond girls that Sir Roger's Bond might settle down with and kind of spend a long-term relationship, if indeed any of them would qualify. Who knows? We're looking at the best climaxes and villains' deaths and all that kind of stuff. So it's going to be a lot of fun today, man.
Is that the best climaxes in the bedroom?
Well, who knows? Who knows until we get there, Chris? But I'm sure there's going to be a couple of oohs thrown in, which will keep us happy. Very nice.
Lovely.
Now, I hear rumours that the JBR family have been out amongst the public again, Chris. And the first question is, have they been behaving themselves? That's the big question. Have they been representing the JBR family in a positive manner, or have they been misbehaving? What's been going on?
I would say it's been highly positive. I've seen, but we've got to put out a recommendation because these family members, okay, so we've got five of the JBR lot visited Prince Charles Cinema.
Mm.
Now, do you know what they were watching there, Tom? Can you hazard a guess?
It was probably at least one James Bond film, I would imagine. Am I right?
Okay. How about one James Bond film for each James Bond actor?
Dude, right. Now, here's the thing, right?
Back to back.
It was the all-nighter, wasn't it? And it was just one after the other. Now, years ago, I went to an all-day Bond showing thing in LA, and there was, you know, it was pretty much that. It was like five films throughout the day, I think it was. And that was tough to arrive first thing in the morning. I loved it, don't get me wrong. But that was tough to get through a full day of that. Was like, by the end of it, it was like my ass was just this numb thing that I couldn't stand up straight and all that kind of stuff. But to do it all night is a very different beast. And I'm a man who likes his sleep a lot. So I don't know whether I'd be able to make it. It's quite the undertaking, isn't it, really?
It is. We've got to give a shout out and big kudos to Brian Dobson, Becca Andrews, John Ward, James Blundell, Richard Neves, and Mark Ashby.
Mm.
Salute all of them because, okay, so the films they got to watch, Goldfinger, Majesties, Spy Who Loved Me, Living Daylights, your favourite, Goldeneye, well, at least one of your favourites, and also Casino Royale. So, I mean, that's quite a banging lineup.
That is an absolute banging lineup, isn't it? I think if you had the job of curating that night and choosing those films, I think that's probably the exact lineup I'd probably choose. I might wobble between Goldfinger and Thunderball a little bit, I think, but I think I'd ultimately go for Goldfinger, I think, because it's, you know, it is what it is. But yeah, that's pretty incredible. And I've seen, I saw the pictures of them going in before and then the pictures of them afterwards. And I've seen a couple of threads discussing like the things that they perhaps picked up on that they hadn't noticed before, because when you watch them back to back, all in one go like that, is quite a sort of a unique thing that you don't perhaps do that often. And I saw a lot of interesting comments. Mark Ashby, for example, we had a big old discussion on Facebook about how he didn't like Living Daylights at all. Like, he actually fell asleep in the middle, which I suppose the falling asleep thing is a tough one, because that one was like right in the middle of the night. It was like at 2 or 3 o'clock in the morning. So I feel like that's unfairly judged on that call. But there was a lot of like, oh, Living Daylights didn't quite live up to the rest of the films and all that kind of stuff, which I'm surprised about, because I thought, if you're a hardcore Bond fan and you're going to go to an all-night Bond thing, I would have guessed that Living Daylights would have been like, well, that's pure Fleming and, you know, Timothy Dalton and all that kind of stuff. I'd have thought that would have been the one everyone comes out raving about. But that was interesting. Lots of interesting comments that I didn't expect to see.
Yeah. Completely. No, definitely. I think a lot of people were saying that no one had a bad thing to say about Goldfinger. Mm. Everyone said it just looked amazing. Obviously, it's the first film of the night, so you're not as tired anyway. Yeah. But everyone came out, you know, saying that was amazing. Interestingly, I mean, I think the majority of people said that Craig and Connery, Goldfinger and Casino Royale stood out, Majesties as well. Yeah. But I did see one or two people mentioning that even Casino Royale seemed to drag for them and didn't quite. Obviously, really? Again, last film, so you've got to take that into account, haven't you?
Yeah.
But, yeah, and instances where Spy didn't quite live up. So, you know, I kind of wish I'd gone, if nothing else, just to experience that, to see, you know, the feeling of watching them all, obviously, back-to-back, and how they stood against each other, how the bonds stood against each other as well.
It's a tricky one, isn't it? Because that's so like, you get in there first thing and you're all excited for this night thing, and then Goldfinger is the first one. You're going to be pumped for Goldfinger. By the time the third film rocks along, you're gonna be starting to flag a little bit in the middle. It's the middle of the night, do you know what I mean? And then by probably 8 or 9 o'clock the next morning, when they start playing Casino, it's kind of like your mental sort of fatigue is going to have kicked in, and it's going to be a tricky one to kind of judge. It's like, would you have been feeling that about Goldfinger if they'd have played Goldfinger last or in the middle? Do you know what I mean? You just don't know.
Yeah.
So I suppose the way to do it would be to watch one film a night for a week. Do you know what I mean? And sort of do it like that.
I don't know. I think if they do it again, which I've heard they're thinking about it. So if they do another Bond marathon, I'll definitely attend the next one.
Mm.
And get a bit of a feel for it. But Becca's written up a blog for the website, and that's up now. So anyone that wants to have a read of that, go along to the Very website nice. And check it out.
Good stuff.
Then you'll find it out about it.
Well, good on the old JBR family for representing at the all-nighter. Good stuff. Good to see them all behaving well. Unlike Brian Dobson over New Year's, he was misbehaving over New Year's, wasn't he? I'm glad to see he's bucked his ideas up since then.
Yeah.
But speaking of blog posts, we've got one up on the website from Benjamin Clow. Remember the fellow from New Zealand who had a little bit of a road accident and just picked himself up, dusted himself down, and just walked off cool as a cucumber, like Roger in Spy, through the desert. He's written a blog for us all about his thoughts on Ian Fleming's Casino Royale, obviously the book rather than the film. So that's well worth having a little butchers at over on jamesbondradio.com, and obviously Becca's report as well. So make sure you go and check that out. What else has been going on, Chris?
Definitely. So basically, we had a couple of comments from the listeners from our previous Roger-spective review. So I just thought I'd mention a couple of them. Now, I know we were talking about some of the stuff that Roger did prior to Bond and everything like that. And Simon Uscuri mentioned that the Persuaders, he's a huge Roger fan, you know.
He loves a bit of Roger, doesn't he, old Simon?
He loves Roger. And he recommended two episodes for the of the Persuaders, which I basically watched before recording this. So them, I think, was called The Time and the Place, and the other one was called Take Seven. Now, The Time and the Place was directed by Sir Roger himself, and it was a cracking episode. Good little car chase. Mm. And Sir Roger drives an Aston Martin DBS in it, the same Does model he? As Lazenby from Majesties, but it's a completely different colour. It's like a real bright colour. But that's kind of cool. And then the other episode, Take Seven, was set, a lot of it was set around Pinewood House and, like, you know, equivalent of Spectre Island. So it was really cool to see that. And you know what? I really enjoyed it. That whole dynamic of Sir Roger and Tony Curtis, you know, and the American and the Brit. It was really cool. And it got me thinking, imagine if they did a remake of that today. Who would you get to play you know, the Brit, and who would you get to play the American? That's interesting.
I would say, because doesn't Roger play, again, not having seen The Persuaders yet at all, which is shameful of me, I know, don't shout at me, JBR listeners. He plays like a member of the aristocracy or something, doesn't he?
Isn't he's like a baron, lord, or something?
He's a lord.
Yeah, that's right.
Brett Sinclair, isn't it? That's what I'm thinking. Brett Sinclair. Yeah. So I would say you would need somebody of similar stature to that. So I would say somebody like the old Cumberbatch. He'd probably be an all right choice.
Yeah.
And then you need a sort of brash American dude to go along with that. So I don't know who maybe a Jeremy Piven or somebody like that. That might be a nice idea.
Interesting, yeah. That might be good. It kind of is similar, I thought, to the Cavill Army Hammer casting for Man from U.N.C.L.E. Yeah. I guess that, you know, to a certain extent, they could have filled those roles as well. Yeah. But definitely check it out if you get a chance, man. It's really cool.
Good stuff.
Persuaders.
Next
and
up,
we also had...
Go on.
Sorry.
I'll let you go. It's all right. We're interrupting each other left, right and centre.
Yeah,
go on.
We do.
Run with it.
Okay. So we also had a message from Britt Vandenberg. Now, this one was really interesting. Okay. So, you know, we mentioned one of the parts from Live and Let Die. One of our best lines was, well, I certainly wouldn't have killed you before.
Oh, yes.
Now, how do you interpret that? Why do you think he says that?
I interpret it as, well, if I'm gonna kill her, I might as well bone her first.
Yeah,
then I'll get my information out, and then if I have to kill her, I'll kill her. That's how I interpret that scene.
Okay, that's exactly how I interpret it. Now, Brett had a different angle on it. Brett basically said that he thinks it's a joke about necrophilia, and he's saying that he wouldn't kill her and then sleep with her. So I certainly wouldn't have killed you before,
well,
and
that
then
got
still
dark
sleep
very
with her.
Quickly, didn't it? Jesus Christ Almighty! Yeah, yeah.
I never crossed my mind that.
That's
one.
A dark one. Now I can't see Bond having it away with a dead body. I can't see him being that kind of guy, to be honest. But I don't know. I don't know whether we'll have to ask Rog next time we see him, you know, but I would say, knowing Bond, what a rapscallion he is, it's like, I might as well get my end away before I have to do the dastard deed. But interesting thoughts, Brett. You might find people giving you a wide berth next time you're around JBR family listeners. They're like, oh, this guy's a bit of a dodgy one. Yes, but interesting perspective nonetheless.
Definitely.
Now, something also very interesting, Chris, that I thought was actually quite intriguing, which was a recent interview with Purvis and Wade, and they were discussing writing Bond for the modern world. This was with The Telegraph, and they said, the thing is, I'm just not sure how you'd go about writing a James Bond film now. Purvis and Wade have worked on every Bond film from Rod's Not Enough through to Spectre. Each time, you've got to say something about Bond's place in the world, which is Britain's place in the world. But things are moving so quickly now, that becomes tricky. With people like Trump, the Bond villain has become a reality. So when they do another one, notice the wording there, when they do another one, it will be interesting to see how they deal with the fact that the world has become a fantasy. Now, that's
interesting.
Yeah, what do you think about that, first of all, Chris?
Well, there's a couple of things. I like the way that you picked out the they, because that's almost distancing themselves from the next one no matter what. And they obviously referring to Eon.
Yeah.
Now, there's quite a lot of stuff about this. Now, I think the whole fantasy, the villain being the president of America, you can definitely see that. Mm. That is there, you know, potentially anyway. But that doesn't mean that means that we can't do another Bond film, or they can't, you know.
Yeah, I mean, that is an odd comment.
It just
to make,
sounds
isn't
like
it?
They're struggling a little bit. I don't know.
Which maybe they are, because they've been writing Bond for years now. It's like, you know, Bond's Not Enough was 99, wasn't it? So it's like, they've been, you know, it's getting on for 20 years ago that they first started writing Bond. So I guess you do hit a point. It's like Fleming himself. It's like by the time he'd written his last book, it was kind of like, it feels like a bit of a drag. I don't know what else to do and all that kind of stuff. And it's drying up a bit. So I guess naturally you do. So I guess it's time to bring in some fresh blood, isn't it? And have a different take on it. But like for me, it's like, I mean, the obvious thing is you just continue the Blofeld story, don't you? And you go down that route. I don't see how Trump being the president makes any difference, really.
like we said before, Shatterhand, the whole Blofeld, you only live twice and all that sort of stuff. It's almost there, isn't it? It's ready made.
It's not even almost there. It's moistened. It's ready to be penetrated and it's ready to be done. It really is.
Yeah.
So, I mean, what else would you do? I mean, that's the obvious one.
But that is the obvious one.
If I was Purvis and Wade, I'd be like, well, that's just the one story we have to tell, because there's so much Fleming stuff in there we can use from You Only Live Twice. We can, you know, do our own spin on it or whatever. Like that to me would be, that's just dished up to us on a plate. We just have to sort of fill in the boxes a little bit, really.
Yeah, exactly. And then, you know, everything that is going on in the world, that can almost be mentioned within the text of the film rather than it being the forefront of the film, can't it? Obviously you'd have something weaving into a storyline somehow about that sort of thing. But yeah, I mean, that is perfect. That's a perfect answer. But I also think what else is interesting on the flip side of things, I think, okay, fresh blood would be great, you know, get someone else in. But also, like we've said before, sometimes they've been at the brunt of like people's, you know, like we've said before,
I'm putting my hands up. I did a lot of slagging back in the day. I did a fair amount of slagging, and I've since eaten my humble pie and taken my hat off to them, because in my sort of discoveries since then, it's actually they were the ones that were, you know, trying to get more Fleming in and be more authentic to the novels and stuff. And it was maybe the director on that particular film that kind of pulled it in the other direction and kind of changed things around a little bit. So, yeah.
Well, they sort of mentioned that there was a bit more of that going on even with Spectre. So basically they were brought in to work on Logan's script, and they prepared several alternatives over a period of 6 months. I think it was mainly the third act that they were working on and the ending. And obviously they needed it to be locked for filming in December. Now, Purvis, he said people were already in pre-production on the film and they wanted to see things all the time. Sometimes they couldn't decide what they wanted until they'd seen it written. So basically, Purvis and Wade had it written that the helicopter crash on Westminster Bridge at the end of the film, that was already constructed, so that had to be used.
Right.
That basically, part of the deal was you have to squeeze this into that script at the end. It's been built, we spent money on it, we're going to use this. So basically, you've got to come up with an idea of how to use this. But the ending that they wrote had Bond walking off the bridge to the only life he knows, basically to go back to MI6 with M, Moneypenny and Tanner, and not to go with the girl. So they basically were going to, that was their ending. And it was like overruled. Basically Bond went away with the girl. So basically Purvis said that you write scene upon scene, you write so much, but how it finally got shaped was probably down to Sam Mendes. So again, here's another instance where they've written something and the director said, actually, no, I want Bond to go away with a girl. Which got me thinking, like, well, that in itself is interesting, but I'd just love to get a really candid interview with them. Sit them down and say, right, fellas, okay, we'll get past the whole sorry for calling you whatever to start with.
Hey, I didn't call him any names. I just want to put that out there. I didn't call him any names. I was just displeased at the time until I was better informed. So anyway, continue.
And basically to say to them, right, okay, so if your scripts had been filmed how you'd written them, how would they have turned out?
Well, that just was it. To hear Do you that. Know what? That was one of the things somebody asked them when they did that panel back at that All Day Bond thing that I was at years ago. And somebody asked how Paul Haggis's contribution to Casino had changed their original scripts. And you could tell there was a bit of like in their voice as they were saying it, but they basically were all about the original Casino ending with Vesper dying in the bath and the note and all that kind of stuff. And then Haggis comes along and says, no, it needs an action set piece to finish the film, which may or may not have been a good thing. You know, when you read a book, it's a different thing to a film, obviously. Maybe you did need that action set piece with the sinking house and all that kind of stuff. And I must be said, that image of Vesper drowning herself there, or drowning herself, but like drown, you know, taking that first lung full of water, haunts me to this very day, man. That expression on her little face kills me. So it is a very emotional climax regardless, I think. But yeah, from what I understand, they were always trying to go the Fleming route, and it was the director that was pulling things in the other direction, which opens up a can of worms with Spectre, doesn't it? Because, okay, so as we discovered with the leaked scripts, if you haven't listened to the 30 Days of Spectre later episodes, go and listen to the one about the leaked scripts, because we go through that with Linda Zhu from Station C. We go through those with a fine tooth comb. And what happens at the end of both the leaked treatments that we got to look at is, as they drive off into the moon set, Madeline says, "Where are we off to, James?" Not in so many words, obviously. And he says, "Oh, I don't know. We have all the time in the world," and off they go. Right. So that was what they were thinking at the time. We have to, like, that's totally, totally a setup for the next film, which is what we're talking about, isn't it? The whole "you only live twice" thing, Shatterhand, Garden of Death, and all that kind of stuff. So that's what they were thinking at the time. Yet the ending was changed. So it's like, actually, thinking about it then, if they had him walking off back to MI6, that scene would never have happened. So no, I'm just so trying to gather my thoughts.
I think that's how they initially wanted it. Mendes then said, "No, we want the girl sort of thing to happen."
Yeah.
And then they probably thought, "Well, let's lace this line in there," and then therefore
it was changed again. Because my thought was that maybe Mendes said, "Let's scrap that last line and have him go off with the girl, because I want to leave it open ended, so the next dude perhaps doesn't have to go down that route if they don't want to, of telling that story."
Yeah.
But then if Purvis and Wade's original one was him going back to MI6, which would have been the end of it there and then, we wouldn't have had that "all the time in the world" line anyway. So maybe that tells me that Mendes was leaning more towards the Majesty's kind of follow-up than not. Interesting. Yeah. There's a lot of you could debate that all day long, couldn't
you? I tell you what is good, potentially good. Well, who knows? But if... it sounds like they're distancing themselves from Bond 25.
Mm.
If they get called, you know, like the previous one, they might get called in to try and, you know, put a polish on whatever whoever's written Bond 25. But whenever they hang up their sort of spurs for good, I think it's got to be a mission of ours to try and get them for like a real candid interview. I think that would be amazing.
That would be good. I think sometimes you have to just wait a little bit until they've got enough distance. Oh, yeah. Do you know what I mean? I think that's probably the way to go. But yeah, I mean, they'd be right up on my hit list of people I'd want to talk to for sure.
Definitely.
I suppose that's an interesting thing, isn't it? Because everybody, I mean, I won't say everybody, but I'd say the majority of people were not happy with that very, very final act once they go back to London, you know. And it's like we said ourselves, it was like, yeah, you probably, what would have been the better thing to do was have had the climax in the crater base, you know. You could have had that sequence. You wouldn't have had to rush that sequence so much where he escapes from the chair and it's, you know, everybody said that goes a bit video gamey and all that kind of stuff. You could have had more of a battle there. You could have had the MI6 crew come over in their matching overalls and had a massive battle like in the olden times, you know, and "You Only Live Twice" or whatever. And then, you know, ends with the huge record setting explosion. And then you just never see Blofeld. And it's like you're just assumed he's dead in that explosion. And then, of course, that leads to him coming out. That, for me, feels like a more elegant ending to that film. But then I suppose even in pre-production, it's like, well, they've already started building the bridge, so we have to use the bridge now. And it's like we've got to do that. And it's interesting to see why that happened and whether, if that hadn't have happened, maybe that would have been the ending, the crater base, and the whole London thing wouldn't have felt so shoehorned in there at the end. I don't know. Interesting.
Well, I still think the whole MI6 building isn't a bad idea. Like going back to it and it being sort of semi-demolished, I think that as an idea works for me.
Yeah.
I just think there is a certain way that it might have been done a bit better, which we've discussed several times before, and we'll obviously talk about when we get round to Spectre in years to come. But but it's interesting. But one day, maybe, hopefully we can get them. But yeah, in other news, Tom, we've heard that the real Q, so in the real life MI6 Q, is a woman.
A woman?
which is obviously really cool. And I think that brings up an interesting point. Now, apparently, I don't know if this has been officially confirmed yet, but Peter Capaldi has stepped down as Doctor Who, and the new Doctor Who is apparently our own Q, Ben Whishaw. Now, I don't know if this has been definitely confirmed, but that's what
rumors on the grapevine.
And I'm not a big Doctor Who fan. I don't really care about it, but obviously Ben Whishaw is really cool, and if he does it, that's great. But it got me thinking: if, say, Daniel Craig did one more, or whether he didn't do one more, if Ben Whishaw were to step down and we had a female Q, who do you think would fit into those shoes? any ideas? What sort of actress do you think?
Well, I think you can't have a sexy Q. Or maybe you would, because the dynamic has to be that they rub each other up the wrong way, doesn't it? Q has to be impatient with Bond because he doesn't respect his gadgets, and Bond is blasé with the gadgets and is like, oh, Q's just moaning about whatever. That's the dynamic that works that we love to see. And it was, you know, right there back with Boothroyd back in the day, back in Goldfinger, and it's still there again today with Wishaw. That's the dynamic that we need. Now, when you combine Bond with a lady, especially an attractive lady, the dynamic changes very much so, doesn't it? So would you have a sort of matronly sort of woman who wouldn't be Bond's typical type, who takes things very seriously, and maybe he flirts with her a little bit, but it never, you know, she just sees that disdainfully? Or would you have a super sexy Q that she was still, like, you know, pissed off with Bond because he didn't respect her gadgets?
Yeah.
But I don't know. I feel like that would, I don't know. What do you think?
Well, I've got two things on this. I think I can't see Q ever being old again, just because of the whole high-tech age and everything like this. Basically, I think the limit on Q's age would be like under 40, I think. They'd need to be.
Well, that's the thing, isn't it? Like we've said before, it's like back in the day, like during the Second World War, for example, all those dudes who were making all the kind of spy equipment for you know, anybody behind enemy lines and all that kind of stuff would have been older fellas. That's just what would have been at the time. And then when you bring computers in, obviously that's a younger man's domain. So it's like, it makes sense now that the Q of today is a younger dude, is a, you know, a little computer geek, which is precisely how they present him, don't they? So yeah, go on.
What I'd like to see, if it ever happened, I think the Q, female Q, could be kind of like, attractive, say, definitely. I think it'll be really good just to make them like hyper intelligent. Like just Bond almost tries to have a sneaky one line, you know, not a one liner, tries to kind of get one up on them, but she just like beats him
just
down.
Knocks him down.
Just through sheer intelligence.
That's like, an interesting one. So maybe the relationship begins by him cracking onto her and her just having none of it.
Yeah.
And then once that's established that there's nothing he can do or say, then it sort of goes into that sort of traditional relationship, maybe where it's just, they just rub each other up the wrong way.
Because the other thing is, you couldn't have it too similar to the Moneypenny relationship, could you?
No.
Because, and I think if you're looking at the Craig the Bond Moneypenny relationship we have at the moment, there's definitely that flirtatiousness there.
Yes.
Like, you know, we've seen it with the shaving scene when she goes to his apartment and stuff like that. Now, you couldn't have that and then go to a Q scene where Bond and that Moneypenny are doing the same thing. That definitely wouldn't work.
No.
So I think you'd start it, I think she could definitely be attractive. In fact, I think it would be great if she was. And Bond is like, oh, hang on a minute, hello, what have we got here? And maybe he'll try something, but she just shuts him down. Like, he's no match for her in terms of wit or intelligence or knowledge of that area.
That's a good
and then
idea.
He kind of goes, ah, okay, bollocks. Yeah. And then basically, then we can go back to almost a Desmond-style relationship, but with a female.
That could almost intensify the relationship with him a little bit more, because basically Bond is this dude who can just sleep with whoever he wants, and this would be the one time where he's been denied that, and that would damage his ego even more.
Yeah.
And it would, that was quite an interesting, you know, maybe when the time comes along for the new Q, I think I'd be down with seeing that, man. I think that would be quite interesting.
Definitely.
Yeah.
Yeah, I just wanted to throw a few names out in the hat. In fact, when I mentioned it, said Gemma Arterton would have been quite good. Obviously, she played Strawberry Fields, and she had that sort of thing about her. I think she could have
Do you know what she would need? If she was going to be a sexy Q, she would have to have that sort of sexy secretary look about her. You know, when they have their hair
the
up
glasses,
and the glasses
definitely.
You know, we see it in the movies all the time, and then it's like, oh, it's no time to go out, and then the hair comes down and all that kind of shit. That's the kind of vibe she needs.
Yeah.
I would say.
Yeah,
and I could see her doing it. I mean, I know Strawberry Fields was a bit of a sort of dumb character, I suppose, wasn't she? She was more in the vein of the sort of old school Bond girls who were sort of like along the bimbo lines. But I could see her pulling off, She would need a white coat, I think.
Yes, she would do. The actress who I'd really like to see is Hayley Atwell. Do you know her?
Not off the top of my head. Let me have a little butchers.
Google Hayley Atwell and have
Hayley
a look.
Hayley Atwell.
Yeah, because she's... I think she'd be a really good female Q. She's
I can see that. Yeah.
Yeah. She's got that sort of, you know, she's got almost like a really attractive intelligence about her. And I can see what you're saying.
From looking at the Google search, she can definitely do the bombshell cleavage out, very sexual kind of vibe. But on the other side of the token, she can also do the very sort of prim and professional look as well. So I think that's a good shout, man. Yeah, good call.
She'd be a couple of other ones. Annabelle Wallace, who I really like. She's really cool.
Let's have a look at that one. Annabelle Wallace.
She was the one that was in the Fleming TV series.
Oh, goodness gracious me. Yes, yes. That's right up my street, that one. So this is devolving again, Chris. What have you done?
Sorry, man.
Jesus Christ almighty. Yes.
Okay, and Charlotte Riley, I think, was another one. That's Tom Hardy's missus. She could definitely do the job. Yeah.
Okay, let's have a little look at this one. Yeah, do you know what? I don't see a female Q as a blonde. I see her as a brunette, I think.
Yeah, so did I.
Yeah, that's another good shout. She seems to be cut from the same sort of cloth as the first one, Annabelle Wallace, I think. Yeah, I could see that.
As a slightly older one, I thought Rebecca Hall. She's perhaps not quite got the look of the other two, but she's a great actress, and I think she could definitely do the...
She's another one. She can do the sexy and she can do the professional. Yeah, I could see that. Yeah. Interesting. So
those were the ones that came to mind. But out of those, I think Hayley Atwell, female Q in about 10 years' time, whatever, I think that would be a great shout. And to have that sort of relationship. So,
yeah.
Barbara, if you're listening, or Greg, if you're listening, then there we go.
Lovely stuff, cool stuff. So we've got some new James Bond comic news from Dynamite Comics. The next range of James Bond stories will be Black Box, and it follows on from Varga and Eidolon and the current story, Hammerhead. The next epic adventure of 007 kicks off in the snowbound French Alps, where Bond finds himself in the crosshairs of an assassin who targets other assassins, a bit like Dexter with his serial killing. This is the first puzzle piece in a larger adrenaline-fueled mystery that will send Bond across the globe to investigate a digital breach that threatens global security. Issue number one of Black Box will go on sale in March. That sounds very intriguing, doesn't it?
Yeah, it does indeed. Now, I still haven't actually read Varga or Eidolon. I know our blog master, Jack Lugo, is well into his comics, and he's obviously reviewed a few of them. So it'll be interesting to see what he thinks when obviously that one comes out as well. Interestingly as well, Dynamite Comics have now released a Felix Leiter series. So he's got his own comic, Leiter, Felix Leiter series. Yeah, that one, he's operating as an independent investigator in Japan, tracking down a beautiful Russian spy from the past. But when the mission takes a turn for the worse, he discovers there are more deadly schemes taking shape in Tokyo and beyond. So there we go. Felix gets his own comic series.
That will be interesting to check out, because that's a question that often comes up, isn't it, of like spin-off movies for Bond of the various supporting characters and stuff. So I suppose that will be a good way to sort of do that, is do it in a literary sense or in a comic book sense to explore that, rather than, you know, no one's going to go and see Felix Leiter the movie, are they, at the end of the day? But, you know, maybe reading a book about it or a comic book would be good. So big news for the James Bond family, obviously. Naomi Harris, Moneypenny, up for an Oscar nom for Best Supporting Actress. That's later this month, isn't it, the Oscars?
That's it. It's 26th of Feb, yep. So only a couple of weeks away. But, yeah, good luck to Naomi. Obviously, well-deserved. Hope she gets it. Fingers crossed. And, it's always nice to see the Bond sort of family get respect that they deserve.
You know what it is? Back in the day, I suppose during the Brosnan era, and probably earlier than that as well, going quite way back, the Bond girl thing was seen as a bit of a curse, wasn't it? In the sense that you would be a Bond girl or you'd be Moneypenny or whatever, and that's all you were ever known for, and nobody else would ever sort of touch you after that. But in recent times, that's sort of been different, isn't it? So she's doing really well for herself, isn't she, old Naomi? She's in a lot of movies lately. She's getting out there. Obviously up for an Oscar. That's great news. It's good to see that sort of flipped on its head, really. Now, Chris, a little while ago, you put out a poll, didn't you? Not a metal poll, a poll of opinion, which was who the JBR family would like to see direct Bond 25, basically a list of directors, and everybody chose. And I see by the little sly grin on your face that we've got some interesting results to peruse.
We have indeed. Now, Tom, this was, I'm really kind of glad we did this because we had a really big response. It's probably like the biggest response we've had from anything that we've put out, which is great. Now, basically, the deal was I put out the poll, a list of directors. Everyone had three choices. So you could list three that you wanted. You had, I think the deadline was only yesterday. So this is like real fresh. Okay, so what I'm going to do is I'm going to list the list of directors in alphabetical order, and then we can go through the actual poll. Okay, so all right. We had Paul Thomas Anderson. So he did There Will Be Blood, The Master, stuff like that. Suzanne Beer, who did The Night Manager. Catherine Bigelow, Hurt Locker and everything. Brad Bird, who did The Incredibles. Danny Boyle, Martin Campbell. Alfonso Cuarón, who did Children of Men and Gravity, really good. David Fincher, Paul Greengrass, Duncan Jones, Sam Mendes, Bennett Miller. He did Foxcatcher, Moneyball, stuff like that. George Miller, who did the recent Mad Max. Christopher Nolan, Guy Ritchie, Steven Spielberg, Quentin Tarantino, Sam Taylor Johnson, Morten Tilden, who did Headhunters, who we love. Matthew Vaughn, Denis Villeneuve, Nicholas Winding Refn, and Edgar Wright. So that's quite a list of substantial directors there. Okay, yeah. Now I have the results here. Now, basically, what I'm going to do is I'm going to go from the bottom up. Okay.
All right.
So Sam Taylor Johnson was at the bottom, but she did have some votes. Female director, so that's interesting. Now, interestingly about her, she worked with Eon doing a James Bond supporting sort of documentary thing with Craig, and Barbara Broccoli was working with her. And you know, Barbara Broccoli's obviously keen on the female side of things and potentially a female director. So that was the reason for her name being in there. That was kind of like quite a cool thing. Then we had Nicholas Winding Refn, Bennett Miller, Paul Thomas Anderson, Morten Tilden came in at 19th, so he's quite far down. Duncan Jones, Paul Greengrass, Edgar Wright, George Miller, Quentin Tarantino, 14th out of all that.
I'd have assumed he'd be high. For me, with him, it's more of a curiosity thing. It's not like I'd be like, oh, he'd make a killer Bond film. No. I'd be like, what the fuck would he do with a Bond film? And exactly. I kind of want to see it out of curiosity more than anything else.
David Fincher was just above him. Now, I think he could potentially do something. We've seen him work with Craig before. So we're kind of reaching the top 10, but joint 11th. Actually, we'll do this first. Joint 11th with Brad Bird and Alfonso Cuarón, both pretty decent. Now we're into the top 10, okay? So this is the big boy club. Joint 9th, okay? Guy Ritchie and Steven Spielberg, two big hitters in the game. Now, Guy Ritchie, I potentially thought he might be higher from what I've heard people say before.
I have to say, I don't want that dude to be involved in Bond at all. That's not for me, one. His old mate Matthew, however, please, not him, though, I don't think.
No, I agree. I think what he does is great doing that stuff, but not with Bond. Yeah. And Spielberg, again, he could have been good.
That's another one I would, out of curiosity, because obviously the whole Indiana Jones thing was born from Bond, so he obviously loves it. Yeah. And I would be intrigued to see what he does with it, because all of his films have that Spielbergian feel to them, don't they? So I just wonder how that would match with Bond and how that would feel. But curiosity, I think, rather than a name that I would say definitely.
Okay, 8th place, we had Danny Boyle. Interesting. 7th, we had Susan Beer, Night Manager. In 6th place, we had Catherine Bigelow. So a couple of the female directors quite high up there. So we're into the top 5 now. Tom.
Okay,
this is
here we
the
go.
Top 5.
We need some suspenseful music, don't we? Like on the lottery numbers.
Yeah. Go for it.
I'll overdub something. I'll underdub it or whatever the term is. I don't know. Go for it.
I'll dub it. Okay. Okay. So in 5th place we have Sam Mendes. So there we are. Sam Mendes coming back to do another one, which I guess would be the Spectre story extended if he did come back, but who knows. Okay, in 4th place we have Denis Villeneuve. This guy did Sicario. Have you seen Sicario?
I haven't yet. No, it's on my to-do list.
Really, really good. He was great. It's really sort of suspenseful and everything like that. Which is obviously pretty cool. He did that Arrival, which is pretty decent as well. So anyway, okay, top 3, man. And now you know some names that haven't been mentioned yet,
do.
Don't you?
Yes, I do.
Okay, so three big names. Okay, and now in 3rd place, with 7% of the votes. So 7%, obviously, is quite a few, so the percentage
quite a lot of choices,
small,
yeah, of course.
7%. Third place, we have Matthew Vaughan.
Oh, that's my boy. Right, okay.
There we go. Matthew Vaughan. I still think he could do a decent Bond film. I'd be happy to see a Matthew Vaughan film.
I heard people say after Kingsman, they were like, because Kingsman is obviously a very exaggerated comic book style spy film, isn't it?
Yeah.
And I heard a lot of people say, well, if that's what his Bond would be like, I'm not sure about that. But I think that's just him having fun with the spy genre.
Yeah,
I think
if
he did indeed do Bond, I think it wouldn't be Bond done Kingsman style. I don't think
it would be respectful.
And obviously, you know, there was that weird little thing when he thought he had a job for Casino, didn't he? He thought he had and went around telling everybody, and then it was like, actually Martin Campbell's going to do it.
He's
obviously a name in the hat, isn't he? He's obviously a sort of interesting.
Speaking of which, he's a name that hasn't come up yet. So, we have two names, Tom. Two names left to call out, okay? Now, I just have to point out that Matthew Vaughan, 7% in third place, okay?
Mm-hmm.
The top two directors had 17% and 19%.
Okay.
So, basically, they cleared everyone else by miles.
Okay.
I think I can predict
one of them at the very least. But go on, go for it. Who's number two?
Okay. So, in second place, we have... Now, this is from a load of listeners, all voted.
Yeah.
Second place, we have... Martin Campbell.
Oh.
So...
Yes, all right.
There
lovely.
He is. GoldenEye, Casino.
Yeah.
Comeback Campbell. I think, you know, particularly if another actor did come on board, brilliant. Campbell would nail it.
Yes. Do you know what? I think the thing with him is this, right? He gets Bond on like a next level. He really gets it. He's obviously reinvented Bond for GoldenEye and Casino. And I heard him say before, in the interviews for Casino, he was like, you know, I didn't really want to do another Bond again because I'd already done GoldenEye. I didn't want to retread over the same thing, blah, blah, blah. But then it was like, oh, we're doing something different with Casino. Okay, it's a different angle. Maybe I will come back and do it. And obviously he did that very well. So I feel like if his attitude is like that, then maybe he would be the man to just draft in whenever the new Bond comes on board. It's like, okay, we've got this new fellow. Here's going to be the flavor of this new Bond. You come in and shape that. You set the template for what the rest of his tenure is going to be.
Yeah.
So, yeah, I mean, I love that dude. I'd happily have him direct every Bond film because he just, you know, he gets it. You know he does. So, yeah, I'm on board with that. Yeah.
Okay, so that's absolutely brilliant. I'd be more than happy with Martin Campbell. But we have to say, the director who came in at number one with 19% of the votes. Okay, so we're talking, this is out of 23 people, and he got 19% of the votes. I think you know who I'm going to say.
I think I do as well, yes.
So the director that the JBR family have chosen to potentially helm Bond 25 is Christopher Nolan. There you go.
Now, what
are your thoughts on that?
I'm totally up for it, right? I see from watching that snow sequence in Inception.
So good.
Even before I think when I saw that, I didn't even really know he was a Bond fan. And then I watched that sequence and I'm like, hang up. This looks just like Majesty's. What's going on here? And what a film to choose to rip off, by the way. Oh, excellent.
Yeah.
And I'm like, okay, so that to me says it all. I feel like, I mean, if a director loves it that much, that he will put a featured section in his film that's a direct inspiration from Bond. I'm like, okay, I want to see what they're going to do with it. And it's the same with the last Batman one he did as well, wasn't it? With the plane, like Sanchez's
License
plane,
to
with,
kill.
The, with that
yeah,
cable,
yeah.
Hang, with the plane hanging down and stuff. So yeah, he's obviously got a love for it, which I think is the most important thing at the end of the day. You've got to have a real love for it and really get that character. In terms of movies of his I've enjoyed, I would say probably most of them, really. I really thought Memento was wicked. I thought all his Batman movies were wicked. I thought, I suppose the only one I thought was, I was like, meh, was that weird space one he did with McConaughey. What was that called?
Yeah, the Interstellar. Yeah, that one didn't quite work for me either. I thought The Prestige was brilliant. I really liked that. Inception is one of my favourite films of all time. Interstellar didn't quite work, but I've heard a lot of people say in regards to Nolan, it will never happen because, you know, he always produces, directs, you know, he's heavily involved in the script.
Yeah.
Would Eon ever bring someone on board who would want to be that heavily involved?
Yeah.
But then if you look at Mendes, he's been extremely heavily involved, perhaps a lot more than previous directors in terms of, you know, he brought in Thomas Newman, he brought in his team sort of thing. And
I think it's a different world with that stuff nowadays, isn't it? Because it's can you imagine any of the other Bonds getting a co-producer credit like Daniel did? Can you imagine? It feels like Daniel has a lot more control and say in the direction of things than any of the other Bonds had.
Yeah.
So I feel like it's a different time now. It's not like I feel, you know, Cubby had his thing of Bond's got to be 6 foot tall and British and blah, 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 and all those kinds of rules, which obviously amazing, and look what he did with the series, it's great. Whereas Barbara, like, obviously Daniel's not 6 foot two and, you know, the traditional tall, dark and handsome dude, he's different. And, you know, he obviously, the story goes with Connery and stuff, they wouldn't give him the extra money and that's why he got the ump and all that kind of stuff. Whereas in this case, Daniel's got a co-producer credit and all that kind of stuff. So I feel like it's a different world with that kind of thing these days. So I feel like the possibility's there. Whereas maybe 20 years ago, it would have been like, nah, they wouldn't have been up for that, you know.
No.
Nowadays, I think it's different. And before, you never really had the name directors either. We've had Mendes on board. Yeah. And in previous years, they've gone with a sort of the, not meaning this is an insult by any means, but like the lesser known and the sort of the cheaper directors, not the big name bad boys out there. That,
or,
you know,
or the ones that have come through the family, like editing, like Peter Hunt and John Glenn and stuff like that, who've been there and come through. That was kind of like previously what they did. But in, I think regarding this list of directors, If one of them was to helm Bond 25 or even Bond 26, I think that would be heavily influenced by whether Daniel Craig did one more or not. Because I think a number of these directors, particularly Nolan and Campbell, maybe Matthew Vaughan as well, if they were to direct, I think they'd want to start afresh with a new actor. I don't think Nolan would come on. I don't think Campbell would come on for one of Craig's. Yeah. I think Mendes might if he, you know, if Craig was going to do one more, and Mendes did it, I wouldn't be surprised. Perhaps, you know, if Suzanne Beer came on, maybe I wouldn't be surprised. But if it's a new Bond, then I think you've got the likes of Campbell, and you've got the likes of Vaughan, and you've got the likes of Nolan, who might say, well, hang on, okay, now this is my time to put the imprint of what I want and stuff like that.
I've read Christopher Nolan say pretty much that it was he'd want to do it if it was, you know, the start of the next actor's run and all that kind of stuff, which kind of makes sense because it's like you're really putting you're defining a whole sort of, you know, if a Bond actor stays in the role for a decade or more, you're defining a whole era of Bond history with that first film, aren't you? So but solid choices, but man, that top three, those definitely are my top three hit list for sure by a country mile.
But interestingly, they do have their haters as well, like you do have people that just don't like Nolan whatsoever. Like, and just think that he would be it would be a Nolan film and not a Bond film. I've heard a lot of people say that, but I think it's got the curiosity, but it's
the case. It's not like, I feel like somebody like a Quentin Tarantino is a perfect example of that. He would make a Quentin Tarantino Bond film, wouldn't he? That would be full of all sorts of strangeness that you've never seen before. I don't get that it would be, you know, it's obviously a Nolan thing. Obviously he has his tropes that most directors do, but I don't think his style would be drastically different from what you know the last few Bonds have been, really. But interesting stuff.
We'll just have to wait and see if any of them turn up for Bond 25 or Bond 26.
I'll do it if they want somebody cheap. I'll have a go. Wicked. All right then, before we get into the Roger-spective, we waffled on for a little bit with all this news and catch up and stuff and the poll. It's been exciting times. Go on.
I've just got one more thing to say, which we have to put a shout out now. This episode has obviously been recorded before yesterday.
Yes.
But we have to mention a big congratulations to whatever five names were mentioned. Obviously, we don't know yet because we haven't done the draw. But yesterday was the draw for the five people that will come on our next episode, which is the fan cast episode, which is going to be great. So whoever those five are, we salute you. We look forward to chatting to you and obviously get in touch and we'll arrange the times and dates and everything.
Indeed.
Like that.
Of course, the third birthday fan cast episode, as we have done for the last 2 years, inviting five listeners on to have a good old chinwag about Bond. So you know who you are, but we don't know yet because you're in the future and we're a weekend behind you. So that's exciting.
This is it's almost like Christopher Nolan.
It is, isn't it? Moment, it really is. It's like that weird bit with McConaughey's poking behind the bookshelf and we don't know what the fuck's going on. Yeah, absolutely. Anyway, so I'm going to do it, Chris. Come and join us on Facebook. Come and like the page. Just type James Bond Radio into the search box. Come and like it and then join in on all the discussions. Come and follow us on Twitter, which is at James Bond Radio. Sorry, it's those actions that kill me. I've only just realized that you do this because I've always been reading off the page and not looking at you. Next up, come and follow us on Periscope, which is very important because obviously that's when you announce the winners of the birthday extravaganza thing. So come and follow us on Periscope because there's stuff on there that you just won't find anywhere else. Come and join us on jamesbondradio.com. There's all sorts of shenanigans going on over there with blog posts and everything under the wise tutelage of Jack Lugo and his blogmaster skills and all that kind of stuff. Subscribe on iTunes. Go to the iTunes store and type in James Bond Radio into the search box. You will find us. Make sure you subscribe so you never miss an episode. Come on over to jamesbondradio.com and click leave us a voicemail on the right hand side. So if you have a question for us or a just something you want to say or what's the other thing people do, quotes, yes the quote rounds. Stick that on there, send it in, we'll play it on the show. How can you help the show? There's a donate button over there if you want to help keep the good ship JBR afloat. That's always very much appreciated but never expected. Also, you can help JBR by getting out there on the social media, sharing our episodes, talking about JBR, getting on the Bond forums and saying come and listen to JBR, it's the best thing in the world, and all that kind of stuff, because at the end of the day, good old-fashioned word of mouth is the most powerful thing of all. So if each and every one of you went out and told five people about JBR, that would be very, very good. Thank you very much.
Amazing. I feel like I should like applaud you for that.
I need a bloody lie so down. It's so like good. A Shakespearean speech it just goes on and on. Yeah.
But I think just to add a little bit to that, in terms of anyone that wants to leave a message, like leaving a quote or a trivia, just make sure you leave two messages. So one with the question or the quote, and then one with the answer. So yes. We've got all we need. Basically.
Absolutely. Cool. Good stuff.
So.
All right, then. So it's time for a listener trivia question. And this time we have a question from one Mr. Colin Peters. So should we have a listen to what he's got to say for us?
Yeah, let's do it.
Hey, guys, it's Colin Peters calling in from the States by way of Iowa with a listener trivia question for you guys. Hopefully this one is relatively difficult for you guys. In which films do we actually see Felix Leiter shoot a gun? Think that over a little bit. Thanks again, guys, for everything you do. Keep up the good work.
Ooh, okay.
That is a tricky one because off the top of my head, I'm not sure I can think of a single occasion when he fires a gun. I mean, it must happen in there somewhere, but...
Yeah, no, I can definitely think of one of them jumps out straight away.
Thinking about it, I might have one.
Yeah. Oh, actually, I think that might as well. Yeah, that's a good question.
That is a good question. That's a brain nice teaser, one. That one. Yeah, all right, cheers, good stuff, Colin. We'll find out the answer to that at some point later in today's episode. Good stuff. So let's have some theme tune, and then we'll talk some Sir Rog.
My name's Bond. James Bond.
Bond.
James.
Bond, what do you think you're doing?
Nipping the British hand up, sir.
Welcome to James Bond Radio. News, reviews, and discussion of all things 007.
Pussy. As you can see, I have no problem with female authority.
Oh, pipe down, 007.
Do you expect me to talk?
No, Mr. Bond, I expect you to buy.
Okay, so just to kick off part two of Sir Roger-spective, we have the first category, which is Sir Roger's best deadly situations. Now, what we'll do, we'll go through all the films, all the Sir Roger films, and think of the situations where, you know, Bond, how is he going to get out of it? You know, this is not looking good, basically.
Yes.
So Live and Let Die, kicking things off. For me, I think one of the most deadly situations has got to be on the crocodile farm. So he's speaking to Teehee.
Yeah.
He's walking across. And I love how Teehee just kind of stops. He carries on speaking. Bond walks onto the island. And then you just hear that sort of winding, cranking noise. And Bond turns around, see the bridge going back, and he's like, shit.
Yes.
Man, shit.
I've got to say, man.
Yeah.
Live and Let Die, you know that's my favourite Roger, right?
Yeah.
To come on board and come out immediately in your first film with some true iconic moments, and this is definitely one of those, is a big deal for me. That crocodile scene is one of those Everyone remembers that. They remember the funeral scene as well, don't they? That's one that kind of comes up a lot. The crocodile thing, that is one of those classic Bond moments. If you're going to make an amalgam trailer of all the Bond classic moments, that is 100% going to be in there, isn't it?
Definitely.
It is a belter of a moment, that is. And I like the way it's not simple cut and dry as well. It's like he tries a couple of things, doesn't he? He's like, right, fuck, I'll just get these bits of chicken and I'll chuck them over here just to keep them at bay. And then he turns around, he's like, magnetic watch, oh yeah, there's a boat. And then, oh, the boat's got a bit of rope tied around it. And it's like he tries a few things before he does it. And what a stunt, man. Like, nowadays, you know what would happen? They would have a CGI set of crocodiles and it wouldn't really happen. Or it would be, you know, fake ones that were just built into the water. And I'm sure they must have had that discussion as well of like, how are we actually going to do this? And they must have thought, oh, maybe we do the fake ones. But actually to do it on real, crocodiles are terrifying, man. To do it on real ones where you run across those motherfuckers. That is such a, I don't think we'll ever see that sort of thing in a film again, because it's a different time now. And I just don't think we'll ever see something that genuinely terrifying on screen again.
Well, the guy that did it, I mean, Ross Kananga, he owned the farm. He owned the farm of crocodiles. So, but they happened across that farm by chance. Yeah. So this wasn't written into the script until they were basically driving past and they saw this sign, as we see in the film, trespassers will be eaten. And they're like, well, hang on a sec, what's that about? And then they went in, obviously found this crocodile farm, and that whole scene developed from literally just seeing that sign and curiosity getting them to investigate. So if that hadn't had happened, that whole thing wouldn't have been in the film.
Yeah.
So it's like little instances like that where that occurs. You know, it's not like someone came up with a script and sort of thought, right, crocodile farm. Sometimes, unless you can't think of something if it's not there, you know, in terms of that crocodile farm, the fact that it's just such a cool idea, isn't it?
Yeah.
And the thing about the scene is when you see him standing there, and it's when the crocs reach the island. So there's a couple and they've got big bellies, you know, and like long sort of snouts with all the teeth. And there's that sound that they make, the sort of, I don't know what, you know, it's just a crocodile sound. But it's like freaky, man. It's so freaky.
Those things are terrifying. I went on one of those airboat rides in New Orleans once around the bayou. There was, you know, he'd put the dude would sort of stop and then the alligators would come up and they would, I don't know if they were crocs or alligators, but whatever. They would come up and then sort of swim under the boat and he would hold up a piece of chicken and they would like open their mouth and he'd drop one in the mouth and all that kind of stuff. And the weird thing was, is like, as they would swim under the boat, he'd reach down and like rub them on the back and stuff as they were going through. But those things are, I equate it to like sharks. You know, when you're in the water and somebody, you know, you're on holiday or whatever, and you're in the water and somebody comes up to you and goes, dun, dun, and does the Jaws theme. And just a little bit of you freaks out a little bit, doesn't it? You're just like, oh, fucking hell. You know what I mean? It's that same out of the element thing that I have no chance against this creature, no matter what happens, unless I have a pencil and I can jam it into its eye socket.
That's it.
Which, of course, Bond didn't have. He checked his top pocket and he didn't have one. Or pull out his teeth.
That is really cool. I like that.
Yeah.
But I think the other thing is putting yourself in Bond's shoes, so to speak, his crocodile shoes.
Yeah.
Is like, how would you have gotten out of it? Obviously, the boat didn't work. You'd think, well, the only thing would be to swim as fast as you can, but there are just so many of them.
Yeah.
But yeah. So for me, I reckon that's probably the best deadly situation.
Yeah.
Live and let die.
For sure. Okay. What do you think about Man with the Golden Gun? I don't think there's a sort of quite such a perilous situation in this one.
No.
Everyone can relate to the crocodile farm, but I suppose you've got, for me, I think it would be the funhouse. And what I like about the funhouse is obviously that's the pre-title sequence, isn't it? We get some foreshadowing straight away that Scaramanga has this sort of funhouse of tricks and traps and all that kind of stuff. It's almost like in Indiana Jones or whatever, when he's stealing an idol and he's got to not step on the right thing to set off the spear guns and all that kind of stuff. It's almost that, but for Scaramanga. And you see what he's got at the very beginning and how Rodney gets, you know, shot in the face or whatever. And then obviously the mannequin of Bond. And then when Bond actually walks into that funhouse, it's almost like the tension's a little bit higher almost because you've seen what it can do. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah. Yeah, no, I agree. I think the music actually works really well in that scene as well, like building up to suspense. Mm. And there's a couple of moments where Yeah, where you think, okay, obviously you know Bond's going to get out of it because it's Bond, but it, I think it's still, you know, Scaramanga's lethal, and like you, there's definitely that sort of, you know, it is a deadly situation in terms of, obviously he's got the sort of light-hearted stuff like the Al Capone and the cowboy and stuff like that, but the actual sort of thought of having Scaramanga somewhere in the shadows ready to like pop one off at you is like you know, that is pretty cool. Yeah, I know.
Yeah,
I knew you were gonna say that.
Sorry, man. Yeah, sorry. I think that for me is is the deadly situation in the Golden Gun. Yeah, absolutely.
I think the only other one is slightly after that where he's trying to get the Solex out, and you can see like the sun goes behind the cloud, and you know you've got that sort of mushroom shaped rock with a sort of, you know, reflecting the sunlight, and then the beam comes down, and it's like that's quite a nice suspenseful moment.
There is a lot of tension there as well, because it's like when he's leaning right over the part where the beam would come, and it's like that would just go straight through you, kind of thing.
Yeah,
there is that. I think I suppose for me, the deadly situations has to sort of almost have a sense of like it being iconic, that it just, it's one of those super memorable moments, you know, which I wouldn't say the Silex beam is, whereas I'd say the Funhouse is one of those things, because it's Scaramanga's lair, it's his bat cave, and it's like a big deal. Next up then, what are your thoughts about Spy Love Me? Give me some deadly situations.
So Spy's an interesting one. Now, for me, the one where I thought Bond was most in trouble in the whole film is actually the fight on the train. Now, I know we're doing like a fighting category later, but I just thought that moment where he faces up against Jaws has got his hand and the hand basically covers all of like Bond's face, and he's lifting him up with one hand. Bond's trying to punch him, it's having no effect. You see these metal teeth, and it's just scary. And that part where he has that shelf and he bites a shelf, and the look on like Bond's face, he's like, what the fuck? And it's like, it's just shit scary. And I think for me, I mean, I'm trying to think of another instance in the film where it's as sort of deadly as that, and I don't know if I can think of one.
I suppose the tricky thing is there are some crossovers, isn't there? Because it's like
when
you think of, you know, certain stunts and stuff, you might think, okay, the parachute jump is a deadly situation. But obviously, you know, we talked about that a fair bit last time, didn't we?
Yeah.
So yeah, it's a tricky one. But in terms of a deadly situation, I suppose the Jaws fight on the train is the one, because
just because you're so confined as well, aren't you? You're in such a small space, and he's massive. So, it is just scary. He's so big in this little cabin sort of thing.
Yeah, absolutely.
It's quality.
But that is, I tell you what, that is a thing, because Jaws in himself is quite an iconic thing, isn't it? So it's like that moment where, you know, Triple X opens the wardrobe and there he is. And then that's like the big jump scare, isn't it? And then you have that whole fight. So yeah, that's I think that's up there for Spy for sure. Yeah, that's a good fight. Cool. Now, what do you think about Moonraker? Now, I know one person who's going to be pleased with this scene choice, but why don't you tell the people what it is?
Okay, so for me, I think it'd have to be, I mean, there's loads of cool things in Moonraker, loads of scenes where, you know, Drax is trying to kill him one way or another. But I think my favourite one has to be the centrifuge scene, the G-force scene, where he's obviously in that sort of little capsule type thing spinning around.
Yeah.
And it's and like in Dan Gale's You Only Live Splice, the editing and that whole scene is just majestic, and the sound effects. You see Chang just like slowly turn that wheel and the lights increasing, and you see Bond start off quite calm, and then suddenly, you know, it's almost his face is sort of flying everywhere, isn't it? And it's just a deadly scene. You think, how is he going to get out of this? You know, he's literally about to pass out.
You know what's important as well is, and this sort of applies to I think one of the most shocking things for me was actually in Casino Royale, is when you see Bond in a situation where he doesn't handle it in a cool way. So, for example, you know, most of the time, Roger will, you know, somebody will jump out at him and he'll just do a judo chop and he's just dead. And he'll raise his arm and just walk off and straighten his tie. And like, that's the Bond, especially with Roger, the Bond response. So like when he's in the centrifuge and it's all the G-force and his face is all, looks like it's melting or whatever. And like, that's a situation where, you know, he can't do that. And the other one we're referencing Casino is obviously when he gets poisoned and he goes and he stumbles into the toilet and he pukes everywhere. It's like, Jesus, you've never seen Bond like doing that before. And I think the G-Force is one of those where it's like he can't just sit there and be Mr. Cool. He's genuinely in some trouble. And obviously in Dan Gale's Unilever Splice, he talks through the whole how John Glenn edited that to make it super tense. And it's like, with a little bit of education about the editing as well, thanks to Dan, it's like, you sort of have a higher appreciation for the scene as well, I think. Yeah.
Go for it. All right. I was just going to say briefly, it also mirrors the Live and Let Die deadly situation, because obviously on the island, like, he's got his magnetic watch, like you said, to bring the boat, but it doesn't work. This time he's got, okay, it's not a gadget, but he's got the chicken switch. Mm. And you think, okay, well, that's his way to get out of it. Obviously that doesn't work because it's obviously been disabled or whatever. Yeah. And again, he has to think of another way to do it. And I think that's adds to those sort of scenes, doesn't it? Where you try something and it doesn't work and
totally
and whatever.
So, yeah.
Ramps sorry, what are you going to say?
I was going to say the other thing about it as well is it's something you've not really seen before, isn't it? I think that's the important thing for Bond is like you see some stuff that you're just like, damn, that's something new you've not really seen. Perhaps, you know, done in a different way than you've seen done on screen before. And it's like, you know, when have you seen a character in a G-Force machine? Do you know what I mean? It's something new and intriguing. Absolutely.
Here's a question then. If you had the opportunity to go in a centrifuge, would you do it?
Oh yeah, man. Like for me, that would be, I would need my wrist dart gun just in case, like as insurance. Yeah. But no, I'd have a go on something like that. I'm not like you, man. I know you're a thrill seeker, kind of bungee jumping, sort of snowboarding off mountains kind of guy. I like to be firmly on the ground, but that for me, that would almost feel like a theme park ride a little bit. Do you know what I mean? You're in, you're strapped in. It's, you know, it's not really going to go that wrong. I'd be happy to do that. Yeah.
What happens if you saw like an Aikido wearing guy, like suddenly take control?
Do you know what? I would be naturally a little bit worried, but also inside I'd be smiling a little bit because I'd be like, this is just like Vaughn. Yeah.
Nice.
Cool stuff.
Cool.
Now, next up, we've got For Your Eyes Only. Now,
yes.
I would say there's a couple here that I'd say one is genuinely terrifying. No, they both are, but I feel one has a slightly more special place in my heart. I think you can't mention For Your Eyes Only without talking about the helicopter sequence at the beginning. If only for like the stunt work involved in that and the piloting. Like I think I mentioned it last time, didn't I? When Blofeld's on the roof in his, or should I say question mark, is on the roof in his wheelchair and then he sort of spins around the chopper and it's like, it looks like it's going to slam straight into the roof, but it doesn't somehow. Like that's the situation, isn't it? I often think, you know, if you were in the back of a helicopter and some shit was going down and you had to get in the front and take control, like, you know, would you be able to do it? And I think that's the ultimate sort of, it's one of those fantasy situations, isn't it? You know? And I think that's a great one. What do you think?
Yeah, I think that's definitely got to be mentioned. It's just, well, that's it. The helicopter's under control. You're in the back. There's nothing else for it, is there? That's the only thing you can do is to get out. And when he's basically hanging off and there's a bit where he slips off the sort of ski runner and he's hanging on by the seatbelt and he's, and you're thinking, whoa, and he's just hanging off by the runner as well at one point, isn't he? And but it looks like it looks great, that shot where he's just hanging on the side and the helicopter sweeps past him like, whoa, you know, this is pretty hardcore stuff. So I think that is definitely a deadly situation. That's
great. It is
what
indeed.
Was the other one you had in mind?
The other one, I think, which because it's Fleming, and I think it's got that sort of deadliness to it, which is obviously the keel hauling at the end of the film, being dragged across the corals. Now, obviously, that's from Live and Let Die, the book, isn't it? That's the end of it's Bond and Solitaire in the book doing that. But like, that's such a sort of you know, it's like Matthew Parker said. He was like, when you read through the Flemings, there's that underlying thing about pirates, isn't he? Do you remember he was saying that pirates are mentioned loads in the Fleming books? And like, that's a classic old thing, especially in Live and Let Die. It was like pirate gold, wasn't it? Was the kind of theme of it, the villain thing. So it's, I don't know, it just has that sort of classic sort of feel about it. That's like, what a, because you've got the sort of, the typical Bond villain thing where it's like, okay, unleash the slow moving dipping mechanism like Austin Powers, you know, like Kananga would do into the sharks or something. Do you know what I mean? And it's like, oh, that's your classic Bond thing. But keel hauling is that, but it's something that they genuinely used to do back in the day. And it's just like a sick form of torture and execution. And I think seeing Bond in that situation, especially because it's Fleming, anytime you see Fleming on the screen just makes it a bit more special for some reason. And I think that's definitely one of those. And I think for me, I mean, I've always thought that helicopter sequence in the beginning is super memorable. And if I was making my Bond greatest hits trailer, I'd probably stick some bits and bobs from that in there. The keel hauling one, definitely as well. So I think they both deserve a mention for sure. But I think because it's Fleming, more of a special place.
Yeah. Do you think the keel haul sequence could be made to feel, because personally, I mean, I love it. It's Fleming. I think it's great. But I didn't get that feeling that Bond was overly in danger. Do you think it could have been made a bit more dangerous in terms of, obviously he gives him a wound, doesn't he? So he's bleeding. Do you think there could have been a bit more, perhaps with a shark or something? I don't know. I think about the whole drowning thing, perhaps, actually. That was pretty, that is pretty deadly, really, isn't it, I suppose? Like,
Well, in the book, there's that line, isn't it, where he's already decided before they even reach the corals that he's going to drown Solitaire so she doesn't experience the pain of it, which is super dark, which reminds me a bit of Quantum, actually. I feel like when the fire is getting him and Olga, like, he's going to basically kill her before the flames get to him just to, you know, spare her. So there is that. So maybe you could have made, but how would you illustrate that on screen? I don't know.
Exactly.
But maybe. I don't know. Maybe it's just the sense of Roger, because Roger is ultimately invulnerable, and it's just But what a scene. Absolutely. Now, I think I can predict how you're going to feel about the next film, Chris, is obviously Octopussy Time. What would you say is the deadly situation from Octopussy?
Well, okay. So, I mean, I love the pre-title sequence so much. I adore it. But I just love that whole thing of that missile just chasing the Acrostar. You know, it's a heat-seeking missile. Mm. Bond's in this plane. Obviously, the plane is fast, but that missile sort of is catching up, and he's swerving and diving. For me, it's not like a fear factor, but it's still like a crazy deadly situation, obviously.
Yeah.
It's going to blow up the plane if it catches it, and it's just using skill to get out of it. So I don't think it's not the equivalent of the sort of Jaws fight where that is scary, but it's still kind of like, whoa, okay, how is he going to get out of this?
Yeah.
You know, this missile's on his tail. What is he going to do to get rid of it? You know, if he keeps flying, eventually it's going to get him, or he's going to run out of fuel and crash.
That's the thing with that. Again, I think the Acrostar is one of those iconic sequences from that era of Bond. I think you would definitely have that in the trailer moment, you know. It's one of those things, isn't it, where it's like breakneck speed. You got this heat-seeking missile right on his tail the whole time, and it's only through his own genius is the way he gets out of it and achieves his mission at the same time and just flies off to safety and coolness. Nice. Yeah, what a moment. Yeah, for sure.
Yeah.
I think for me that's like the standout deadly situation, I guess, in Octopussy. Have you got any other thoughts?
Yeah, there's one little one which maybe is slightly more towards the fear side, is when it's a train scene. It's when he's in that little cabin in that in the carriage where Mishka or Grishka rocks up, and you know, he's examining the Romanov star, and he's got the blowtorch, and basically he almost blinds Bond with the blowtorch, and Bond is trying to like hide, and these knives are coming at him, just missing him. And it's, again, it's the whole feeling of like a real confined space with someone trying to get you. And I think that really does it for me in those sort of situations. And I think that's a really good one as well.
Yeah, very nice. Absolutely. Yeah, cool. Again, I think it's the foreshadowing as well that works with there, because at the beginning, obviously, you know, is it
009?
009. You know, he's in the clown suit, he's running along, you see Mishka and Grishka in action, you know, with the throwing knives and all that kind of stuff, and then again you see Bond face off with them later. So there's that's like a dramatic tool, isn't it, when you see that what they can do early on in the film. It's almost a tension builder by the time they get to meet Bond.
But it's like Hinks in Spectre with the thumb in the meeting room, which I think would have been nice if they made a bit more of that in the train fight. That's the weird
thing,
Bond,
isn't it? It's like that was in the script, that he was going to try and do the eye gouging. Why they took that out, I don't know. Yeah. I really don't know. Strange that.
They should have done more with that.
Yeah, they should have done, anyway, for sure. And then finally, for the deadly situation segment, we have A View to a Kill. Now, for me, I think, what do I think? I think the most deadly situation for me is,
there are a couple, aren't there?
there's a few. I think, you know, the Golden Gate Bridge being up there having a fight with, you know, a madman with an axe is
hanging off the old mooring rope and stuff like that. Yeah,
that's definitely up there with the deadliness. But for me, just because it's such a cool shot, I love the hanging off the blimp thing. That one shot, like we talked about when we reviewed it, where he's hanging off and you've got the Golden Gate, big wide shot in the background, and you've got dan, 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 dan on the score. Like, to me, that should be an iconic Bond moment of all time, that one. In fact, I'd love a print of that, like just, you know, a nice framed print of that for the wall, because I think that's the bollocks. Yeah, I think that's for me. I suppose it only overshadowed by going over the aerial over his, you know, over his gentleman's region. That I'd say that's probably that would be the bit I'd be most worried about anyway. Yeah. But I don't know. How about you?
Well, yeah, no, I mean, that image is great. It's just so high up, isn't it? When you see that, and it's one little slip and that's it, he's gone. So I think that is obviously it. Really deadly situation. I think definitely an honourable mention has to go to the underwater pipe and impeller bit where, you know, the water's being sucked in and he just tries to, I know we've reviewed it recently, but, you know, his fingertips are almost getting the grate, but not quite. And then it sort of sucks him towards the deadly blade. And obviously he manages, he thinks of using his air tank and gets him out of it. But that whole scene is like real sort of tense and you think again, you think, shit, how's he going to get out? Well,
again, with something like that, what I feel is scary is when you're out of your element. Do you know what I mean? It's like I was saying about the sharks or the alligators. It's like once you're in that water, you are the weakest thing there because there's all these sorts of creatures in there or whatever that are infinitely stronger than you. You've got the thing about breath being the most important thing. Yeah. And if you don't have access to air, then you just fuck straight away. So there is that. And there's that sense of panic as it's like sucking him in for sure. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah, freaky stuff. Cool. All right then, Chris. So I'm gonna make you choose your all-time favorite Deadly Roger situation
out
of that list. I'm going to make you choose. I've already chosen. I can go first if it makes you feel better, if you need a bit of extra time.
You know what? No, I think I've got it. Well, I've got two. I've got two.
You're not allowed two, Chris. It's not the rules.
I might have three. okay. Well, I think one of the ones I'm going to not choose because I think that could go under a number of categories. So I'm left with two. I'm left with two, and they're hard to choose, man. Can I tell you two or not? And then if you have one of them, I'll have the other.
All right. That's fair. Sounds good.
Okay. The two that I've got for deadly situations would be Crocodile Farm and Centrifuge.
I'm having Crocodile Farm. That for me is just... A, because A, it's deadly, but B, because, you know, the stuntman did it for real. And it's, you know, there's that, obviously you see the outtake where it came up and he just caught the back of his shoe and he sort of stumbled onto dry land and all that kind of stuff. So that was it. Yeah. And then the dude picks himself up and does it again. Do you know what I mean? It's like, it's so crazy and out there and it's so memorable. I think for me, hands down, that is the one that sticks out for me. And I would wager most people as well, even like casual fans, they will remember the crocodile sequence. But go on then. Talk to me about your other one.
So, I mean, the Centrifuge would be my other one. I think it's just,
I thought you were going to go Acro Star.
No, I mean, as an action scene, definitely is brilliant. Yeah. But in terms, it's not quite a... I don't get the fear factor in that one.
Yeah.
I suppose I don't really in the Centrifuge, but it's just Bond looks so close to
He looks buggered in that one. In the Acrostar, he's, you know, eyebrow raised, he's taking a casual glance behind him as he sort of swoops out of the way. Whereas with that, he genuinely feels like he's in a bit of peril, doesn't he? Yeah, sure.
So I think those two are great ones.
All right, cool stuff. So moving on then, we have the fist fights of Sir Roger. Okay. So what do we have for Limlet Dykris?
Okay, so this is going to be a little bit of a tricky section because I know, again, Roger's film gets slated quite a lot for his fist fights, but there are some really decent ones in there. Okay, maybe not all of them, but obviously we're going to go through a few here, but there are definitely some worthy of mention. So looking at Limlet Dykris, I guess there were two that I can think of. One which is over before it starts, really, which is the Baron Samedi one, which doesn't really happen. There's also the Kananga one, but it's more blades rather than the fist fight. I mean, it's still pretty decent, ends up in the water. But for me, I think the best one is a fight against Teehee on the train with that one. I think that's a really solid one, a really solid fight.
One thing I suppose you have to take into account here is that the close quarters fight on the train is a close quarters fight all around is sort of a Roger trope, isn't it? But I suppose when I think of Bond on a train in a fighting situation, I think of Red Grant, obviously. Everybody thinks that. I think Teehee and Jaws and obviously now Mr. Hinks. Like those are, for me, like the four train fights from Bond. And obviously Roger's got two of those. So, yeah, it's one of those, isn't it, where like that's, I guess, is like a precursor to the Jaws fight in the sense that, again, he's outmatched and sort of outgunned, and Teehee's like this sort of strong dude with a giant metal claw and all that kind of stuff. And it's through his ingenuity that he gets rid of him rather than brute force and all that kind of stuff. So, yeah, solid fight.
Yeah, I like the way he sort of uses the deck of cards and Teehee, he's smashing up the sort of cabin with his arm. And, you know, there's a belt where he's got the arm against Bond's sort of throat, and you can tell Bond's been like strangled. He's only just getting out of it. And obviously he manages to get the tweezers and then sort of flip him out. But I think that's a really good fight. And the way that he dispatches him just out the window and the arm's just left there hanging, I think is great as well.
That is nice.
So for me, I think, that's definitely my favourite.
Only Sir Roger would bring a pair of tweezers to a fist fight, wouldn't he? Very nice.
That's great.
Nice. Good stuff. So okay, what else then? So is with Man with the Golden Gun. Okay, so you got several here. I already know my favourite. With this bit, obviously we've got the fight with the thugs inside his room, the belly dancing girl at the beginning.
That's it.
You've got the fight with the sumo wrestlers in Hyphax Garden, and you've got Chula's karate school. So any thoughts about those?
I, in terms of actually a proper fist fight, I would opt for the first one, the Saida's dressing room one, because he's up against three blokes, so it's Roger against three. The actual fighting is pretty decent in this. You know, he uses his wit. He gets that aerosol can and sprays the guy. You know, there's a part where he grabs someone and smashes their head like three times. And that's like pretty hardcore. That's pretty brutal for Watch. You know, the mirror gets smashed and there's a guy that's like, as he sort of grabs him and Rog spins him around as the chair gets smashed on him. So yeah, for me, I think that's for a Roger fight. That's definitely one of the, more solid ones, I would say.
I'll give you that. I think for me, I would probably say most people in agreement that the combat and the physicality isn't perhaps Roger's strong suit. You know, when you compare him to a Daniel or a Sean or somebody like that, it's you know, more of a subdued, laid-back fighting style, or certainly a George as well.
Or so, Pierce or Tim.
Oh, yeah. There you go. All right, across the board. But what I like is the ingenuity side of things, like things only Roger would get away with, you know?
Yeah.
So for me, hands down, my favourite in Man with Golden Gun is in the karate school. Like it's almost like with Indiana Jones, where the dude gets the swords out and he just shoots him. When the dude bows and he just boots him in the face, like,
that is good.
Such
that is
a cheekiness,
really good.
And it's funny, and it's like, that's totally what Roger's Bond would do. I love it. That for me, even though it's not really a fist fight at all, it's just one boot to the face, that would be the thing that makes me smile.
That's
you know
good. That is good. And then he fights Chula afterwards, doesn't he? And that's like it is quite a comedy moment, really. Yeah. And again, with the sumo wrestlers, where he's grabbed and like he squeezes their ass and then, you know, twists their nappy, whatever they call it.
Yeah, that's the thing. I think with Roger Bond, obviously, he's not a sort of, you don't get that sense of physicality and deadliness to him. He's a lover man, Bond, isn't he?
Yeah.
That's what encapsulates Roger Bond, which I think is why I love him so much. But that gets my vote for Man with the Golden Gun for sure.
Okay, what about Spy then? What sort of fist fights and Spy?
So,
is taking the Jaws one aside, because we've used that in deadly situations. We can't use that for fist fights. Obviously, that would be the number one. But moving that aside, are there any others that sort of take your fancy?
Do you know what the one that sticks in my mind is? And I think it's an iconic moment, and it has been referenced in another Bond film, which is obviously Shandor on the rooftop. That little fight sequence, hanging onto the tie, you know, where's Becca? Pyramids! And then down he goes. What a helpful chap.
Yeah.
Love that shit, man. Love it.
Yeah.
And again, it's one of those things, isn't it? It's not when this is a Roger fight. So it's not, you're not going to get that super high paced, like breakneck fighting. It's going to be judo chop Roger, you know, raise the eyebrow Roger. And for me, like that one, that's a trailer moment for sure. Yeah. And I think that's my vote for Spy. I don't know. What do you think?
I think it's got to be mine as well. I think, like, he loves the old grabbing onto something and kicking out with both legs, which he the does. Kick, there's yeah. a bit, yeah, there's a dip, bit where Shandor sort of got him in a thing and he sort of chops him and stuff like that. There's a lot of judo chops and stuff.
Yeah.
Now, again, the fighting's, you know, it's quite a slow fight, but again, he uses his sort of, uses his ingenuity a little bit. And the bit with the tie and the finish is quality. That's really close. And I can't, you know, when you said the line, what a helpful chap.
Yeah.
I can't hear that line and not hear dogs barking afterwards. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah, I get it.
But
yeah.
It's always there. It's always yeah. there. But I think there's definitely an honourable mention has to go to when he's outside the pyramids and Ivan and Boris are like, you know, he comes out and she's like, where's Fekish? With the pharaohs, whatever it is. And then yeah. and then they sort of attack him. Again, it's not the quickest fight, but he does lots of judo chops and sort of chucks one over and stuff like that. And I think as sort of like as Roger Moore fights go, that one's not too bad either. But in terms of iconicness, then definitely the Shandor on the rooftop.
Absolutely.
Has to be up there.
Good stuff. Next up, then, we've got some Moonraker action. What's your thoughts yeah. on the Moonraker fight?
So we've got a couple here. I think in terms of longevity and deadliness, the fight in the glass factory with Chao is just quality, isn't it? Because, you know, he's all proper in his Aikido gear. He's got the stick. It starts off like that. They go into this priceless glass factory and just everything gets shattered. There's that bit where he takes a bowl off and then puts it back and immediately gets smashed. And it's really good. And obviously they go up to then the warehouse Char gets a chain and tries it's to a strangle
fight.
Him and
this
stuff
is
like
the
that.
Opposite of your close quarters, isn't it? It's a yeah. multi-venue fight, this one, isn't it? They go all over the place with that one.
They do indeed.
And it does have a great ending as well. I like it. It's a good yeah. dispatching at the end. Yeah.
Yeah. Yeah, I think so. There's a couple of good fist punches and stuff thrown in as well. I think that's a solid one. I think you can't sort of not mention the whole cable car thing with Jaws. Now, it's not really a fight, and there's a bit where Jaws is very clumsy and he's kind of like just stumbling around. So, but it's still iconic because it's on top of a cable car, isn't it? So in terms of iconicness, that would be the one. But in terms of like a proper fisticuffs sort of thing, then I reckon of the glass factory one.
All right, interesting stuff. So we are now moving into the late Roger period with Few Eyes Only. So really, I suppose the main one here would be when he takes on Kriegler in a monastery. So what do you think about that one?
To be honest, it's not all that memorable for me. I think it's a classic punch him in the abs and nothing happens. And like, you know, Kriegler's obviously like another Grant or Hans and stuff like that. And it's not the longest fight either. But it's pretty decent. He obviously picks up that thing to chuck at Bond, and Bond uses the candle holder to like push him out the window or whatever it is. And it's all right. I think, you know, falling to the death is good, and BB's there watching it happen, which is pretty cool. But it's all right. It's all right. It's not too bad. I guess you could say there's that kind of a fight with the ice hockey players earlier on, which is quite cool. Because again, they're all in gear. They've got sticks. There's that guy that tries to kick him with the ice skate and it gets wedged in the side. And that's kind of like, whoa, you know, Bond's proper out muscle, or at least, you know, out armed in a way.
Outmatched, outgunned, and all that kind of stuff.
Absolutely. So I don't know. What do you think of those two then?
Yeah, I think again, when we get to this stage of the game, I think there's you know, like I say with Roger, I'm looking at more of those kind of like the cheekiness of Sir Roger's combat technique rather than the actual, you know, combat itself.
Yeah.
So yeah, there's not much to sort of work with there. I'd say it's a pretty run of the mill fight. You know, it's certainly not going in the trailer for me, I don't think.
But
there you go. So Octopussy, you got a couple of choices here. As the Octopussy man, I'm gonna let you go first.
Okay, so the couple of scenes I think of, well, you've got the train fight kind of thing. So this is obviously Bond and Govinda. Now the actual sort of fist fight isn't a huge amount. Obviously, Govinda has that big scimitar and they're sort of wrestling on top of the train. They have to duck under the bridge, and there's a bit where Bond sort of flips him over, doesn't he? And he gets back up. And so it's more of a grapple, really, than a fist fight. But it's worth mentioning just because the fact that it's on this sort of moving train and everything like that.
Rather than specifying fist fight, it should just be the fights, shouldn't it?
Fights, really? Yeah, the fight scene. So I guess that's pretty cool. And then obviously he gets thrown off. In fact, there's that bit where when Mishka or Grishka's got the knife and he's about to kill him. That could be a potential deadly situation. But anyway, but I think the other one, which is probably a bit more worthy of a mention, is when Bond's in Octopussy's sort of palace type
island.
The island, that's what. And the three thugs turn up. So you've got the one with the yo-yo buzzsaw, you've got one with like a crowbar type thing, and one with an axe or whatever it is. And this fight I really like. Now, for a late Roger period, this is probably one of my favourite. In fact, this might be my favourite Roger fight of the whole series. I'm not just saying that because it's Octopussy. If you watch it, he's really good in this. There's that bit where basically the guy comes through the door, he gets his arm, he wrenches it behind his back, like proper hardcore, and then grabs his head and slams it into like the tank so that Octopus gets sucked onto it. He's really good in this. Like he sort of, you know, does the old judo throw on one or two of them. And you know, for me, I think this is probably my favourite Roger Moore fight in the whole series.
Interesting.
Really good. Like really hardcore. You watch him, he's nails in this one. It's like,
Nails. I like it. Yeah. All right. Good stuff. And then to finish up this section, obviously, we've got A View to a Kill with two fights that stand out. You've got the gorillas at Stacy's house, obviously. And then I should say, obviously, Mac Zorin on the top of the Golden Gate Bridge. That's the big one, I suppose. So, yes, I would say most people by this stage of the game, Roger himself even said it, it's kind of like the fight scenes. I suppose you could also include the one with the friendly henchman in the basement in the stables downstairs in the factory room.
Well, I did actually write that and then I deleted it again because I just saw.
Probably best not to mention. So it's kind of one of those things. Again, there's the, for me, I think the fight on the Golden Gate Bridge is the winner, A, because of the location, but B, you do get that sense of it being pretty frantic, and it's sort of like we were saying, when you've got an older Bond like that who can, you know, no longer has the young man's physicality and stuff, if you try and put him in a situation where he needs to do that and he can't quite pull it off, then it just doesn't really come off on film. Whereas something up on top of a bridge like that, it's all very frantic and it's close quarters, and you know, you got the axe involved as well, and it's less about doing an amazingly choreographed fight. It's more about shit, I've got to stay alive and not put my foot in the wrong place, because then it's game over. Do you know what I mean? And I definitely have that thing. Like when you know, if you go up in a tall building or whatever and you look over the edge and you just sort of sense how high that is, you get that weird little feeling in your belly, don't you? You know what I mean?
I've got that feeling in my feet right at the moment. You know, sometimes when you think you slip and you kind of get all the pins and needles in your foot. Yeah, I've got that just thinking about it.
So that for me, there's a level of panic in that fight that you don't get in the other one. So that one gets my vote for A View to a Kill as well. I think the gorillas at Stacy's house is one of those where it's sort of like, it's just a run of a mill thing. It sort of does its job, but it certainly wouldn't be a set piece that you would sort of call back as a classic moment.
Again, the Golden Gate moment, that would be in the trailer for sure as well.
For sure. Absolutely. It would be. All right then, Chris, I'm going to make you choose your favorite once again. So again, I want one. I don't want any cop-outs this time. I want one fight. That's what I'm looking for. And if you want me to go first, to give you some time, I'll happily let you.
Yeah, go on. You go first. Go on.
Right.
You go first.
My one, because of the cheekiness of it, it's at the karate school with the boot to the face. And I'll give you my reasons. It's because, A, like we said, Roger isn't the most physical Bond. Those sort of frantic fights aren't his thing, you know, the high-speed fights and all that kind of stuff. What I like is the cheekiness of it, which is the Roger fight that only Roger would get away with. And I think that, for me, sums it up, the cheekiness of it, you know?
Okay, really wicked. How many am I allowed again?
One.
No, honestly, one. Okay, I've got two. Am I allowed to?
You're not allowed to, Chris. How many times?
Well, I'm going to tell you one, but I'm not allowed it. But I'll just tell you.
All right, go on then. This is your official answer then.
So the one that I'm not allowed is Teehee on the train in Live Let Die. I think that's a really cool one. Deadly, got the claw and everything like that. But the one I'm going to go for is actually, purely from a sort of fist fight point of view, is the three thugs on Octopussy's Island. Just because I think Roger's really good in that. And like, that's probably where he's at his best in terms of taking them on.
Brutality. But, yeah, so that's, all right. Good
yes,
stuff.
Indeed.
All right. So that's the fist fights in the bag. Now, next little category. And I've got to say, man, this is not going to be an easy one to choose our favorite.
Not at all.
There are some belters in this one. Absolutely.
Yeah.
So this is the chase scenes of Sir Roger. Now, there's a lot of chasing going on in the Roger period, Chris. So why don't you kick us off then with Live and Let Die? What have we got?
So this is going to be really tricky because, A, there are brilliant chases in each film. But not only that, most of his films have at least a couple of chases. So we're going to go through each one. In fact, all of them that I've listed has two chases. So starting with Live and Let Die, the two that we've got, I mean, straight away, you've got to mention the boat chase just because, you know, it takes up probably a fifth of the whole film in terms of time, but it is quality. You know, you've got that huge leap over the sort of road. You know, you've got, you know, he swaps boats and does all that. You've got the big explosion at the end. You've got going across the sort of, you know, the wedding party and all that, being chased by several other boats. I think that's great. But you've also got the whole double decker part, which I think is, you know, it's got iconic moments in it where the roof gets sheared off. And, you know, he's being chased by the cars and the motorbikes and stuff like that. Two really good chases. I think between the two, I mean, I do like the double-decker bus. It's good fun. But the boat chase is just epic.
The tricky part of that is they are both trailer moments, aren't they? That's the thing.
Yeah,
you're gonna You're going to stick that bus moment with the roof being sheared off in the trailer. And you're going to stick, at the very least, the jump in the boat in the trailer or, you know, carving across the wedding party or something in there. So that's a tricky one. I think for pure sort of spectacle, it's got to go with the boat chase, isn't it? I mean, that's a great one. Definitely a trailer moment. It's like, you know, for the time, some stunts going on there that you wouldn't have seen before or perhaps not done so well. You know what I mean? It's it's a belter, that one, for sure. Okay, good stuff.
Definitely.
So moving on to The Man with the Golden Gun then. Oh, my goodness me. Right, we've got some stuff going on here. We've got another boat chase, obviously a different style of boat, through the water markets here in Bangkok. So you've got that, and then of course you've got the car chase sequence where you've got the spiral jump as well. Now, yes. So let's start with the boat chase then. So what do you think about the mirroring of Live and Let Die? Because obviously we've had a J.W. Pepper involved boat chase in that, and then we have another boat chase with J.W. Pepper involved, just a different style of boat chase. So talk to me about that one. What do you think?
Okay, so I think it's played a lot more for laughs in Golden Gun than Live and Let Die. I like the moment where he shears the other boat in half, you know, and the others fall into the water. I really like that little Live and Let Die cue that you get when J.W. Pepper kind of catches a glimpse of him.
Squeedy,
you hear that? Yeah, I think that's beautiful. I love it. But overall, it really pales in terms of, compared to the Live and Let Die boat chase, in terms of being like a hardcore sort of chase.
Yeah.
So I think it's there purely for a bit of comedy. Obviously, you get the bit with the kid, 20,000 baht, 20,000 baht, and all that sort of stuff, which is great. You know, it's funny and, you know, and all that sort of stuff. But I think the Live and Let Die one obviously overshadows it by
It's a different style of chase, isn't it? It's like when we compared the Spectre chase to Quantum. Quantum is an absolute breakneck, frantic chase that just like, damn it, that's hard. That's an amazing sequence that is really breakneck. Whereas the Spectre one is played a bit for laughs and it's also furthering the plot. It's a whole different style of thing. So I think it's the same thing applies to this. This is definitely more done for laughs, like you say, for sure. Next up then, you got the old car chase, obviously, with the spiral jump, which is, I mean, let's just talk about that for a minute, because that is another, that's like the crocodiles. Like that is one of those standout iconic moments that people will be talking about for years to come. Even now, this one is the same. I feel like, not that I've seen, have I seen any of them? I think I saw the fifth one, the Fast and Furious, very car-based action movies and all that kind of stuff. And I feel like if anything outrageous is going to happen in terms of car-based stunts, it would have happened in those films. Yeah. Like I say, I think I've only seen the fifth one or something random. I haven't really seen any others. So I might be totally barking up the wrong tree. But I'm just going to put my flag in the sand and just say that beats anything. The old spiral jump, that is.
But it does. It literally does, for so many reasons. The car chase itself is pretty decent anyway. You know, I like the fact that they go down the street. Okay, J.W. Pepper's with him and you've got that sort of thing. Some people don't like that, but, you know, it's a bit of fun, isn't it, I guess, that he's with him. And then, obviously, they get to sort of the part where the river is, and they see Scaramanga on the other side, and it's like, shit, you know, obviously he's got away. And then obviously they see that bridge, and it's just lined up and it looks so good. And the fact that they did it in one take, the fact that it was all worked out with computers, and the fact that it looked like it was about to fall down anyway, you know, the way that they sort of designed the bridge, it looks like it was about to crumble even if someone stood on it. So it looked perfect. The penny whistle thing, that's been said a million times. We don't need to worry about that. But yeah, that whole bit is just amazing. Like that stunt is completely unreal. And do you know what? I don't know if I've seen it in any film. Like you mentioned the Fast and Furious, they do lots of cool car stunts or whatever. I don't even know if it's been done. It must have been done again because, you know, that's back in 74 or whatever. But I don't think you can do a car stunt that's better than that, basically.
No.
It's just not physically possible.
I think if you did do it again, it would just be a direct homage because it's just, you know, it's just such a unique sort of sequence, isn't it? A new stunt for sure. All right, then. Next up, we've got The Spy Who Loved Me. Now, oh, my goodness me, Chris, we've got two killer chase sequences in this one. We've obviously got the ski chase from the pre-title sequence, which is a belter with an amazing earth-shattering stunt. You know, one thing that has to be said, man, is there is that thing of Sean being the original Bond, and we've even said it ourselves, like Sean ticks all those boxes, and then all the other Bond actors, they have their strengths and they also have their weaknesses, where Sean really sort of gave, I would say most people would probably agree, the most like well-rounded, like he ticked all of them boxes. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
So with that said, I think credit where it's due to Roger. When we're going through things like this, it's easy to forget just how many amazing iconic moments that dude has in his films. Do you know what I mean? Like it's okay, Sean was there first, but fuck me, man. That spiral jump is amazing. That parachute ski jump is amazing. There's so many. The crocodile farm is amazing. There's so many. I've said it again 1,000 times in the last sentence. It's all amazing. It's so good. It really is, isn't it? And it's when you go through a list like this and you're like, damn, man, it's easy to forget how many there are when you don't see them in list form like this. So talk to me about Spy then, Chris. I've waffled on long enough.
Okay, cool. All right, so looking at the ski chase then, I mean, this is quality just because, well, we've seen it and heard it parodied so many times, but you know, he's obviously got these guys on skis chasing him with guns. He's got a ski pole that turns into a gun.
He does
some that flashy backflip McTwist jobby off the thing and knocks one over.
Yeah.
And obviously you've got again that whole bit where that could equivalent have been a deadly situation as well, where he's skiing to the edge of this cliff and you're like, what the fuck, you know, what's going to happen? How's he going to get out of that? And then when it just cuts to silence, it's probably one of the most perfect moments in cinema. Just that real cool music cue cutting to silence as he just drifts off the edge. And you're like, that is beautiful. It is. Yeah. That is absolutely beautiful what they did there. And it is, it is iconic.
It is, isn't it?
To the extreme, basically.
It is so iconic. And it's one of those things. You could stick Bond on the laser table or the Golden Girl up there and it sits alongside those. It's second to those or Honey Coming Out the Sea. It's fucking right up there, shoulder to shoulder with those classic moments for sure, that is. And it will be forever. Yeah, it really will be. All right. So there's a lot going on with Spy, isn't it? We've got quite a lot of chases. So we got the Lotus versus the bikes. Now talk to me about that.
Okay. So this is pretty cool because it goes through sort of various
sections
and adversaries, shall we say. So obviously it starts off, he's bombing along in the Lotus with XXX, and that motorbike has been following us for the last mile and all that, and then you see the motorbike with the sidecar bomb which gets launched, and there's a truck coming the other way, you think fuck, and he just pulls out and gets in time. Obviously it blows up and you know all those feathers and he still can't fly and the bike flies off and stuff, and then you think wow, he got out of that, and then suddenly like the car rocks up with Jaws, and Jaws looks so funny because it's like this, what is it, a Ford Cortina, whatever it is, he's in this like little Ford,
baby,
like,
car
and like massive Jaws, and then you've got all these sort of guys hanging out with guns shooting at Bond, and that bit's really great, and then Bond obviously uses he gets a cement on the windscreen, and then they sort of crash over and fall in that hut, where Jaws comes out and dusts himself down. Again, brilliant, brilliant scene. And you think, he's safe now. And then what happens? Helicopter rocks up, like with machine guns just firing at him. And you think, fuck, there's with another bit. With
lovely Naomi inside, of course.
Oh, yeah, so beautiful. Like, so good. And like, she gives him that sexy wink and you think, oh my God, this is amazing.
Yes.
And then like, but that, the skill and the maneuverability, I've said it before, but that the way the Lotus spins around that sort of, you know, does that sort of 360 and goes back on itself, and the helicopter tries to copy it, and then and he outmaneuvers the helicopter, which is amazing. And again you think he's getting away, and then suddenly they pass a corner and there's a helicopter again, and then obviously it goes into the whole bit where it goes to, you know, goes into a submarine, says goodbye to an uninvited guest, and
it turns into a submarine, Chris, doesn't it?
It does.
I mean, that's just the coolest thing in the world, isn't it? It really is the coolest thing in the world. And I have to say, these two sequences are both, they both have an unfair advantage over all other chase sequences in cinema history. Would you like to know what that unfair advantage is?
I do. What is it? You tell me.
Bond 77, man. When that kicks in, anything, you could have just had Bond having a stroll along the seafront, and that would have instantly become one of the best scenes ever, purely because Bond 77 is on the soundtrack there. What a belter of a tune that is. So that raises the game for me totally with both of those sequences.
Completely. Yeah. Oh, I love it. Lovely. Okay, what about Moonraker then? What about the chases?
Okay, so we have the Bondola chase. Now, this one is obviously played for laughs, isn't it? I mean, let's face it. It's not going to be, you're not going to see Daniel in a Bondola. You're not going to see Timothy in a Bondola, are you, at the end of the day? It's one of those, what does it do? It just sort of, it's not a frantic breakneck chase. I wouldn't say it's a particularly cool chase either. It's one of those that's sort of like, you know, you got a double take pigeon involved, you got a lot of comedy and sort of slapstickness involved, and then you've got him cruising across St. Mark's Square in, you know what I mean? It's a silly chase, isn't it? But we're forgetting the key ingredient, which is Sir Roger, if there's one Bond that can get away with it, it's Roger. And I've actually said, I think that would be the one thing that would save Die Another Day, is if you had Roger in the lead role, I think I'd be cool with it. You know, I think that's what it all boils down to.
Well, you know what I do like in that scene though? Like, first of all, before it turns into like the hovercraft sort of thing, it kind of turns into a speedboat, doesn't it? So it's like a gondola turns into a speedboat. And that bit's quite cool because obviously there's other speedboats chasing him. Well, even just prior to that, I love the bit where the funeral boat passes and the coffin opens up and the knives come up. And you're like, whoa. And then the guy sort of just rises up, gets this sort of, the guy who's punting, and then like almost gets Bond. Bond gets him. Coffin goes back down.
Yeah.
Hit a bridge. The coffin comes off and you've got that guy going... as he sees the coffin underwater. That's a quote for next week. But I love that bit. I think that's brilliant. And then the speedboat is pretty decent. And then obviously when it gets to the hovercraft, then it goes a bit crazy. But I mean, maybe not iconic, but certainly memorable.
Well, I think as crazy as it is, you probably would stick that in the trailer, wouldn't you? Do you know what I mean? That's like, I suppose the trailer in my mind is like a greatest hits moment of Bond in general throughout the ages. Do you know what I mean? All the actors included, a big blancmange of Bond's greatest hits.
How long is this trailer, by the way?
It's going to be pretty long, isn't it? Let's face it. Yeah, it's not going to be a 3-minute jobby for sure. But I think you would stick the Bondler in there because it is a standout moment, regardless if you love or hate it, isn't it? It's one of those things.
I think so.
But then obviously the other one that deserves mention is the speedboat chase on the Tipperary. So this one, obviously you've got like a Q-boat style thing, like almost like The World Is Not Enough, haven't you? He's got mines on board and all that kind of stuff. And then you've got the climax to it when he gets in his hang glider and all that kind of business. So that's a cool, I mean, it's kind of, you know, it harks back to Live and Let Die in some cases, doesn't it? Because it's, you know, boats versus boats.
And from Russia a little bit.
And from Russia as well, actually. Yeah, that's a good point. Yeah. But like, I do like the climax of it, man. The boat just going straight over the edge of the waterfall. He sails off to safety, or relative to safety, I should say, in his hang glider. I think it. I think that moment would be a trailer moment on the hang glider. But I don't think that particular chase would make it onto my trailer. I don't know.
No, I do like the gadgets. Like, you got the mines, you got the bulletproof shield thing that comes up. You got the mines, you got that torpedo, which is great. I do like the moment where So he's just got rid of one boat, you know, blown up one boat, and then another one comes like flying out over these sort of bushes or whatever, lands in the water, and he just looks back and he stops and he looks back again and does a slight double take and sees Jaws behind him, and he has a smile. It's almost like, you know, it's almost like, you know, you recognize an old mate or something. Yeah. He's like, you know, there he's almost proud that, you know, there he is. And that's kind of like a nice moment. And then obviously, it gets the hang glider moment, and then Jaws sort of pulls off the steering wheel and it goes down, and it's completely for laughs then. But yeah, it's still a decent one, but I agree, taking away the hang glider, perhaps it wouldn't go on the trailer. But yeah, you know, still worth a mention.
Good stuff. We've only got a belter coming up now, Chris. We've got a belter. For Your Eyes Only, the 2CV driving the country chase. This, to me, has one of my all-time favorite Roger moments, all-time favorite Bond moments involved, which is obviously they're burning down these streets, frantic kind of chase, and it's fun to see. Obviously, there's the comedy element involved because he's in a little banger, basically. He's not in you know, the luxury car that we're used to him being in, which is a nice little twist, obviously.
One of my
all-time favorite Roger moments is obviously when the goons pull alongside in the car and he just happens to look, and then double take almost, and then just gives them a little nod. That to me, I just love it. I don't know why. It just gets me. It warms my cockles.
Yeah. Well, do you remember we had the opportunity when that guy in the kevved up car passed us once, and he did it to you, didn't he?
Yeah.
And he smiled over.
We talked that story before, didn't we? Was it, we were on our way to see Spectre or Cue the Music, one of those two?
It must have been both of those.
We're bombing along the road on the way into London, and this little chav comes up behind us driving like an absolute bellend in some souped up, whatever it was, I don't know. And then, so he's basically driving right up your back door and then coming back and then overtaking, then like just driving like a dick, basically. And we were both slagging him off, saying, look at this penis driving like a spaz. And then he pulls alongside us and he does the Roger thing. I remember I looked across at him ready to think, like, let's see what this dickhead looks like. And he looks at me, makes perfect eye contact, and just gives me the nod like that. And I was like, you know what, man? All is forgiven. You might drive a car like a bellend. You might have a cunty wagon. But at the same time, I now think you're a million times cooler than I did 5 seconds ago. Yeah. So have it, man. Go with it. Yeah.
Completely, man. Completely. But yeah, no, I think that chase, I think it's great. The whole not that low and go backwards, forwards quickly, and all that sort of stuff is great. And when they're just bombing down, all the olive trees are flying off or whatever it is. Again, like, it's mainly played for laughs, but it is a quality
and
chase.
And something like else, that. Chris, which we've neglected to mention, which again raises the game on this, is again, one of my favorite pieces of music from Bond. Love it. Yes.
It is good. It is good. It's great. So that's car chase. Car chase done. But there's another chase where, again, this is a brilliant one. So it's like skiing. He's got, obviously, Kriegler chasing him. Well, it starts off where Kriegler sort of rips off his number, doesn't he? And he sort of walks up the hill in his skis.
Yeah.
And Bond is just skiing along, and suddenly he's got that gun, and that's a lovely moment. I know this is precursor to the chase, but that's a great moment, I think. And then, obviously, his one of his poles gets, you know, basically shot. And so he's skiing away, and then so Kriegler chases him, and you've got the bikes with the spiked tires and the machine guns chasing him, you know, ends up going on the bobsled course, doesn't it, where he's behind the bobsled, and then the bikes following down and stuff. Mate, like that. It's so much cool stuff.
Like we said when we reviewed For Your Eyes Only, that is an unsung chase sequence, man. There is some brilliant stuff in there. You know, skiing down the bobsleigh run with those dudes on the spiky motorbikes and stuff. Man, that's some serious cool stuff.
And he's got that really cool ski jump moment, obviously, where he's going down and I think is it Charles Dance sort of knocks into him, and then they sort of fly off, and yeah. and he goes through the bunting, doesn't he? And then that kicks off the music, and yeah, it's just such a cool chase, because it's quite a long chase, but it goes through loads of different sections, and it all seems to work really well for me. Yeah. So out of the two, it's quite tough, that one. Could you pick one out of those two?
It is a tough one, because both of those, again, would be trailer moments for me. Like, you definitely have the 2CV, and you would definitely have that ski chase, because that to me is up there with Majesties, with all the ski work on that film. Like, that's a brilliant chase. And if you haven't seen that for a while, I would urge you to stick your old DVD in and just watch that sequence alone, because that is a belter of a chase sequence. Yeah, I do struggle. Like, one of those is more comedy, one of those is more frantic chase, isn't it? So it's like whichever one you want to go for, really. But I guess we'll come back to that in a minute. So next up, we have Rupia. We have the Tuk Tuk chase from Octopussy. How do you feel about that one?
Okay, so again, I guess it is played for laughs, isn't it? They're in tuk tuks for goodness sake, so obviously it will be. But again, you know, so you've got Govinda with his sort of blunderbuss that he's firing. You've got VJ with his company car and all that sort of stuff. And you know, it's pretty when they go down the steps, and you've got the guys in the Jeep, and they start attacking, and VJ's using his tennis racket. And I do like the fact that all the sort of thugs in this have these weird sort of exotic weapons, you know, that sort of star thing that he sort of stabs in Bond's chest, and the sort of weird blades and all that sort of stuff, I think is really cool. So it is quite a cool chase from that point of view, I think. It's not like your high speed car chase or anything like that, but it's you know, you've got the whole bit where he jumps over the camel. I know some people aren't too happy with that, but you know, overall I just think it's a bit it's a like comedy a fun chase, really.
It's not going to win awards for like groundbreakingness, but it's a comedy chase, isn't it? It's one of those. It's a fun one, isn't it? I would rank that alongside sort of like, not ranking is the wrong word, but like I would put that in the same family as like the 2CV chase, the Bondola chase, all of those kinds of things, the rather
golden
than
gun boat chase,
all that kind of stuff. And then of course we have the Alfa Romeo car chase. So what do you think about that? Now, so you go on. You're the Octopussy man.
No, you always do that. You go first.
All right. Well, I just like to give you Octopussy sort of kudos, because that's your movie. I tell you what I do remember is as an iconic moment is getting on the old rails, you know, blowing out the tires, getting on the rails and burning along, because every time I go over a level crossing, that crosses my mind. It really does. It's like every time I go in a car wash, I think about poor old Tibbet, you know. It's the same sort of thing. So again, you're doing something a little bit out of the box there, which I've not seen that in any other film, so I say bring that on.
Definitely. That's so good. I think maybe that's how things should be judged, is how much you kind of recall them in everyday life. It's like whenever you think of a Bond moment, that just strengthens that scene or whatever it is even more, doesn't it? Yeah. And that's definitely one of them. Same thing. Like whenever you see the train tracks or the crossing, I always think of that. In terms of the Alfa Romeo chase, I think it's quite underrated in terms of like car stunts, and is really fast paced. Is you know, he's got the German police cars after him, and there's lots of like a bit of drifting going on, which is quite cool. Obviously ends up in the US Air Force base and he gets out. I definitely wouldn't call it iconic, and I wouldn't call it memorable, and it wouldn't be in the trailer, but I still think it's underrated in terms of like the actual speed and the car sort of stunt work that's involved. But you know, it's not bad.
That's a fair point. Totally. And then finally, we've got Avtak. Oh my God! We've got the Eiffel Tower Mayday in parachute Bond in car chase, which again, it's one of those where it's unconventional, isn't it? It's not two cars just having a little chase. It's car versus parachute, which again, have you ever seen that before in any other films? I would wager that you haven't. So again, that's one of the things that sets Bond apart in my book. Now, what takes this to the next level? We have the roof of the car being shorn off, not unlike, I should say, the Live and Let Die bus, and then being taken to the next level again by being smashed in half and still going. So that's quite the sequence. And you know what? You are going to stick that in a trailer. That's what I would say.
You definitely will. And there's a part where he like spins the car down the down the steps early on. And there's a part where he jumps onto the bus roof and drops off the other side. That is a pretty amazing stunt.
That really is. Isn't it?
And because it's in quite a comedic moment, that kind of gets overlooked. But that's some hardcore Remy Julien stunt work going on there. And then obviously when it gets sort of smashed up, it's play for moments. But that image of him driving like the front two wheels with the rest of it gone, again, you won't have seen that anywhere. And that is pretty memorable, that bit. It's great. Absolutely. Yeah, and the fact is, although it's comedic what's happening, it's still sort of suspenseful in terms of the music and the fact that he's just trying to get Mayday, you know, he's intent on doing it. Mm. So it's kind of a bit of a juxtaposition that way, but that, I think that works really well.
Totally. And then the other one, which I would wager is another, maybe it's a trailer moment, maybe it's not actually. I'm going to let you decide this one, which is obviously the horse race, or chase, with Zorin and all his goons and all that kind of stuff. Now, in the sense of that, that's one of those things, isn't it, where it's like the Ewoks in Return of the Jedi when they set up all the traps, isn't it? It's the same sort of thing that Zorin's got for Bond. So, again, I wouldn't say this is like an iconic sequence. I think of it, obviously, it's a standout sequence from Avtak, but like I wouldn't say it's an all-time killer moment. I don't know. What do you think?
No. I'd say on the trailer for Avtak, we'd see it on there, definitely. Like maybe like the bush coming out or the pole going up or whatever. But in terms of the Bond trailer, no, I wouldn't put it on there. No, but it's still a decent thing. I like the fact that Zorin's got his, you know, he's playing with his toys sort of thing, so to speak. And it works well within the film and that scene. And like Bond, obviously, Zorin doing the injection and then Bond jumping Inferno over the thing and seeing the car and stuff like that. Mm-hmm. So it is a cool scene. I really like it as a scene, but I wouldn't put it in the trailer. But still pretty decent, though.
All right,
Chris, Tom, I'm going to ask you. I'm going to get there first, and I'm going to ask you, what is your favourite? This is tricky, man. What is your favourite Sir Roger Chase? I'll tell you. I'll give you two if you let me have two.
Right. Let me just. But
you have to choose. You have to choose your favourite out of the two.
Oh goodness.
Which means that's your one. But yeah. This is hard, isn't it? Okay.
It is. I've got three, actually. You've got three.
No, I'll give you two. I'll give you two. You're not having three.
I'll tell you what I'm going to do. I'm going to choose my one favourite, but I'm going to have two runner-ups that deserve an honourable mention. That's what I'm going to do.
All right. Before you say anything, let me quickly get mine. Okay, so I've definitely got that. Oh, and that. Shit. Okay.
Oh, no, there's another one I've just seen. Shit. Yeah.
I've got three chases.
Well, I've how many about have half you got? A dozen, so let's see how we go. All right. Okay. So. Fuck.
I know what my favorite is, but I've got two honorable mentions.
I'm going to talk through a few because this is a very difficult one. So I feel like the spiral jump from Golden Gun is unbeatable, but the rest of the chase isn't. So much. Yeah. It's just that bit that I think is great. Yeah. So that's an honourable mention for me. If it was the best stunts, I would say that's definitely it. I guess.
Which you could also say about the pre-title of Spy with the ski chase, because that moment's amazing. But if you take that away, the rest of it isn't quite up to the same level.
I'll give you that as well. Shit, this is a tricky one. Okay, I'm just going to go with my gut, Chris.
Okay.
I'm going to go with my gut. Right.
Okay.
I'm going to say my favourite is...
Go on.
The 2CV chase. That's what I'm going to... Nice. ...is my favourite.
Okay.
Yeah.
Superb. All right. You? I really like it. Okay. If I had to choose one, mine is going to be... Boom, 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 boom. That was so bad. Mine is going to be the Lotus versus the bike, the car, and the helicopter.
That's
and
nice.
Ending up in the water. I think for me, it just got so many wicked bits to it. Obviously, Bond 77, if you didn't recognize what I was trying to do. Yeah. Bond 77, brilliant. But you've got like the sidecar bomb, you've got Jaws firing in the car, going in the hut, you've got Naomi in the helicopter, you've got the Lotus using all its gadgets and being like driven like really well. And mate, it's just brilliant. Yeah, so for me, that's my favorite. So
that's a beauty. All right, good stuff. Cool. Like I say, honorable mention to the ski chase from Furos Only, because that is a
that was going to be my honorable mention. I just dropped a pen.
All right, cool stuff. So that's the chase scenes in the bag. Next up, I'm very excited about this, which is generally speaking, just the coolest Sir Roger moments. Now, I feel like this might be one of the hardest sequences to choose, sections to choose from, because there are simply so many cool moments. You kick us off then with Live and Let Die.
So I basically tried to choose one from each film. There will be plenty of others, but so Live and Let Die, the coolest moment for me is when basically Roger is in the bathroom. The snake comes in. You can see this snake crawling across the floor, and he's just, you know, he's just had a shave or whatever, and basically he sees it in the mirror. The snake's basically about to bite his ankle, and obviously he gets the can and his cigar and turns it into a flamethrower, burns a snake onto the floor, and then just gets a bit and does his cheeks and like just carries on. And for me, that's so cool.
That for me, I must say, is something that comes to mind a lot, speaking of how it affects you in everyday life. Obviously, the story I told about the fellow in Bangkok where a snake came up on the toilet. Basically, if you haven't heard that episode, whichever one it was, there was a news story last year from a man in Bangkok where I currently live, where he had his little morning poo. He was in the middle of his morning poo and a little snake had swum up. I didn't say a little snake, a big one, swum up the pipes and basically bit him on the penis. It wasn't just a bite and then he's gone. He clamped down, and so he's like wrestling with his fucking thing for 20 minutes. Anyway, so after I heard that, of course, living in the same city, I'm like, right, I've got to be careful about this. So I do a little reconnaissance every time it's poo time. I go in there and I'm like, right, let's just have a little check. Okay, coast is clear and away we go. So this scene is foremost on my mind. I know this snake in Live and Let Die doesn't come out of the toilet, but it's, you know, it's a bathroom related snake incident. So I do need to take a cigar in there with me and my shaving cream.
Which begs the question, could we ever see a Bond scene with a snake coming up the toilet and biting him on the...
Maybe. That could be it, you know. I could see that, yeah. I don't know. There's certainly one of those, isn't it? It's like the laser between the legs. Every man in the world sort of winces a bit at the thought of that.
Yeah.
And getting bitten on the penis by a gigantic snake could definitely make you wince. You're wincing right now even, so...
I am.
Yeah, all right, good stuff. Cool. Snake flamethrower. That's for Live and Let Die. Obviously it's tricky, isn't it, because there's a lot of these categories overlap. You could say the alligators is a coolest moment and stuff, but we've sort of already covered those in different categories, so there's that. What do you think about Man with the Golden Gun?
Right, I think I've got a different one to you, because I think I know what your one is. My coolest one is a very small moment in the film. It's basically when when Bond and Lieutenant Hip are spying on a high fat's place, and basically they're outside the garden. There's this big giant wall, and Lieutenant Hip is standing on Bond's shoulders, peering over the edge, you know, way too much security and all that sort of thing. And Bond is just standing there smoking a cigar really nonchalantly, just like chilling, as if it, you know, as if there's no one standing on his shoulders. And he just looks the bollocks, man. He looks so cool. It's a small moment, but Roger just looks effortless in that scene.
He does.
It's so good.
Yeah, good so choice. Good. I think for me, I don't care if this crosses boundaries and sections, Chris. I know what it's going to be. It's when he chucks Goodnight in the wardrobe, plows Miss Anders while she's sitting in there all night, and then when she's got the ump in the morning, he tells her her turn is going to come and not to worry. To me, that's unbeatable. It really is unbeatable. I love it. It's so terrible, but also hilarious at the same time. So there it is, straight out the gate for me. Moving on to Spy then, Chris. Talk to me about that.
Now, again, I mean, I couldn't think, I didn't want to, well, this one just jumped out. It's obviously the parachuting off the cliff with the Union Jack. I mean, I know we've mentioned it a lot. That is without a doubt the coolest moment in the film. Nothing comes close. But if we've mentioned it too much, what would you say would potentially be the next coolest moment in the film?
I would say another cool moment is...
driving
into the water was going to be
into the water,
because
yeah.
they're almost the same thing, isn't it? It's like you ski off the cliff, off the mountain, and you're like, oh shit, what's he going to do now? Parachute, Bond theme kicks in, glang-a-lang-a-lang-a-lang, right? Beautiful. Yeah. Excellent moment. Perfectly executed. Whereas with the car chase, it's the same thing. It's like, oh shit, we're on this little jetty thing. Where are we going to go? We're driving straight into the water. Most people, that would be game over. But no, it changes into a submarine, which again, I feel is that's right up there as a cool moment for me. I think.
And also, I think driving out the water, because every time I'm at a beach, I think to myself, imagine just seeing a car driving out the water now. How cool is that? Yeah. And obviously, So I think those are definitely... worthy of being coolest moments in the film.
Absolutely. Now, cool. With Moonraker, there has never been a period in my life or a situation, I should say, in my life where this would be remotely achievable. And it's a relatively simple thing. But I love this so much, which is obviously when he's out with Drax doing a bit of shooting. Yeah. And then Drax says, "You miss, Mr. Bond." And he gets, "Dead eye." And then the dead man falls out the tree. Perfect. Yeah. Perfect moment. I love that. I love it so much. But, you know, it's not one of those things where you can actually replicate that in real life in any sort of real way. So it's a tough one, that, but I do love that moment.
That's, that is pretty awesome. I mean, it is a perfect sort of scene, that, isn't it? It's just so cool. And that's my one as well for that film, definitely. I know we had it as one of the best one-liners as well last time, but it's just such a cool scene.
Okay. For your eyes only, Chris, talk to me about that.
Okay, so for me, I mean, this is probably the most iconic moment in the whole film, which is when, it's the same sort of scene. It's basically, now this one, he is Nails. So this is, he's done his running up the stairs and he's standing wide stance in the archway, the stone archway, with his gun. A car's driving right at him, locked behind the wheel. There's Mercedes just going full pelt and he just stands there, rock. Yeah. He takes aim, fires, obviously gets locked. The car sort of spins, teeters on the edge, as we all know, throws in the little dove and then kicks it off. And that, those two bits, the kick in the car, but also the bit where he's just standing there, not giving a shit as the car's driving towards him and then just shoots him. He looks so good. That'd be a great poster moment.
There. I tell you what, man, that's almost like if they'd have kept in the direction of Your Eyes Only, I feel like that's almost like the reinvention moment of Roger. You've had, you know, the first four films, you've had sort of comedy Roger mainly, you know, a lot of things played for laughs. That moment for me is like no nonsense, all business Roger Bond, you know?
Yeah.
That moment, and then obviously kicking Locke off the cliff as well. It's like if they were going to be like, you know what, let's for the later Roger films, let's keep on this darker theme. I feel like that is the moment right there that would have been the turning point, you know? And that, again, for me, that's an iconic shot with, you know, legs apart, guns, dead eye down the barrel of the gun. Like that is a brilliant, brilliant moment. I love it. Yeah. So good. So good.
Cool. Okay, so what about Octopussy then? Do you have any cool... I know what your coolest moment is. I know.
Mate.
No, you've never mentioned it before.
I've never mentioned this before, no. But it's. I won't put people through it again because I've probably mentioned it about 500 times during the Roger period, which is double sixes. Fancy that. And it's because he doesn't look down.
Does he not look down?
He doesn't look down. Chris, I would have
to have a little peek. Why does he not look down? How does he know?
Because the dice is loaded and he knows. But even if I knew that and I was in that situation, I would still have to just check. I just would have to have a quick glance. Yeah, I'm all right. Double sixes. Yeah, well done, Kamal.
Yeah.
Fancy that.
Yeah.
Whereas Roger is so cool, he doesn't even have to look. Fucking brilliant. Okay. Oh, God, there I love go. That. Yeah.
Okay. Okay, so moving on to Avtak then. Coolest moment. What do we have for that one?
Let me see. Okay, so... go on. What were you going to say?
I think the breathing the air out of the tyre is a pretty cool moment. Like, using his ingenuity, you know, he's... You're thinking, how is he going to get out of this? Obviously, he's watching Zoran and Mayday through the water. He knows he can't just swim up. Using that, I think that's definitely a cool moment. I'm trying to think if it's the coolest in the film or not, but that's definitely a worthy mention.
I would say, do you know what? That's one I think of a lot. Like, I don't know why I do, but like that's sort of the, you know, the creativity of Bond, isn't it? That sort of out of the box thinking, which I really appreciate. Yeah, that's definitely that. I would say it's a different kind of thing. I don't think this is, because a lot of these are like Bondian moments, aren't they? Like really sort of gut Bond moments. And I don't think this is one, but it is a cool moment for other reasons, which is obviously where he's carrying Stacy down the fire ladder outside City Hall. And that's like a huge hero moment, isn't it? You've got the big score. Dun, 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 dun. Everybody looking, he takes a slip and everybody's going, you know, and all that kind of stuff. Like, that's a real hero moment, isn't it? It doesn't strike me as a particularly Bondian hero moment, but it is a cool moment nonetheless. But I would say, if I'm thinking of bondage, I would say the breathing from the tire is a cool moment. It's like out cool of the box scene. Thinking. Yeah.
Okay, now this is the trickiest question of all. Which is your favourite, coolest Sir Rog moment? Now, out of the ones we listed, there is a lot there.
Yes.
I mean, mate, there is a lot there. That's so difficult.
Do you know what? I think
There's one.
One of my choices would be in the Citroen chase with the nodding to the goons. It's such a small throwaway, not even on screen for 2 seconds, but I love that so much and I use it in regular life. I say out of that list, it's got to be double sixes, I think, for me.
Yeah, double sixes. Or the parachuting off the cliff as well.
It is so great. That is a cool moment. And Good Night in the Wardrobe for me is amazing as well. But I suppose the parachuting one, that does come into a lot of different categories. Yeah. So I would say it is probably the coolest moment of the whole film in Spy, I would say. But if I'm having to choose now with how I'm feeling right now, I'd say double sixes.
Double sixes. You cannot get cooler than that. If the epitome is unbeatably cool, that double sixes is you basically can't beat that in terms of being cool. That's brilliant stuff. Okay, so the next category, Tom, we're looking at is which of the Bond girls Sir Rog would most likely settle down with. Now, we've picked two girls from each film.
Yeah,
Live and Let Die. You're Roger. What do you think?
Definitely not Solitaire. She's too inexperienced. Roger's Bond would, you know, obviously he's deflowered her. Congratulations.
Several times.
Yeah, several times he's deflowered her. And, you know, congratulations. If you're going to deflower anybody, Solitaire would be an amazing choice. And you could really, there's the extra level of the fact that you're taking her powers away as well. So there's an extra little sort of sweetness to that,
and,
I guess.
And like you always say, what an investment as well.
Future, my friend. Yes, good God. Yes. But she's obviously very inexperienced and very sort of immature in that sense. Not as an insult, but obviously she's lived a very sheltered life. I can see Roger's Bond getting bored with that very quickly. Rosie Carver, I don't see that happening at all. She's too ditzy. She's too easily scared by hats with feathers and stuff and scarecrows. Yeah, don't see that working out at all.
Okay, man with the golden gun.
Goodnight, I would say, is a similar sort of thing. I see Goodnight as his sort of little
go-to bit on the side.
Exactly that. Yes, I was going to say he's got his little back book out. Oh, I'm in Hong Kong. Yeah. Who shall I give a call to? Goodnight. Yeah, okay, I'll give her a call.
Definitely.
And that's going to be as far as that ever goes. It's not going to go any further than that. Yes, no, absolutely. Definitely the bit not. On the side. Miss Anders, I don't see. It's different for Octopussy, but in Miss Anders, I don't see there being much chemistry between the two of them because of the situation of the characters. I feel like Miss Anders is you know, that sort of haunted woman by Scaramanga's presence, and she's so scared. I don't think she's really warm and open. She's just trying to get a job done. So I don't think that would work either.
No, me neither. Okay, so Spy Who Loved Me. So we've got Naomi and we've got Triple X.
Go on then, you give some thoughts for this.
Okay, so, well, they're both kind of rivals. Obviously, Naomi's kind of like the femme fatale. I mean, it'd be hard to say no, though, wouldn't it?
I mean, wouldn't it? Good like, Lord. Yeah.
Absolutely stunning, Naomi is. So I think, obviously, he wouldn't settle down with her. She works for Stromberg. But I think, you know, he doesn't get to plow Naomi, does he?
I suppose he doesn't, no.
No, which is a shame.
If I was Roger, I'd have had the script change. I'd have said, listen, I ain't showing up to work until I get a bit of a scene with Naomi going on. Yeah,
exactly. Okay, so Triple X, would he settle down with her? Obviously, they've got the whole, they can appreciate each other's background and all that sort of thing. But the fact one's British and one's Russian, is that okay or not? But I don't know. I think he definitely go back there again. I could see him go back there.
I think
again.
I think the only relationship they would ever be able to have as two people who live life in the fast lane, they work for two opposing governments, and they're always going to be abroad doing their thing on missions and all that kind of stuff. So I can't see it. Yeah. The only I would say a long-term friends with benefits situation,
yeah,
whereby, yeah, you know, they would never get married and settle down, but they would perhaps, yeah, you know, when rather like Polo Ivanovo, just when their paths, yeah, cross,
exactly,
they, yeah, would, yeah, have a little bit of, you know, a fun time. And that's obviously who Amasov was going to be, Polo Ivanovo at one, yeah, point, or rather the other way around, I should say. So, yeah. Yeah, that's what I would say with that one. Cool. I think there'd be too much, yeah, competition there as well.
Yeah.
Now, what about Corin Dufour from Moonraker, Chris? I know you're very, ooh, partial to,
yeah, a
bit,
I'm
of
a big fan of, yeah, a bit of fan, big fan of Corin. I think again, the a bit too naive for Bond. You know, not quite there. He basically is just using her for information, isn't he? So, so I think that would just be the one night or whatever. I think Holly Goodhead, they've got some good chemistry going on. I think their one-upmanship works really well. And you, yeah, know what, now I come to think of it, obviously again working for a different, you know, agencies or different governments, whatever, I think, yeah, I think there's potential there, maybe, I don't know,
in the aftermath
of the, yes, spy world, perhaps.
I think the one-upmanship, there would be definitely be a sense of competition amongst them, but when they've retired from the service, I think they could potentially work out, yeah, together. Yeah.
Yeah, I think you're exactly right. If we're looking at the world of Sir Roger James Bond, I think when he came to retirement, he'd get out, if he did have this black book, he'd have full of like one night stands or women to like hook up with in several countries. But I think he'd go to Goodhead and he'd go, right, let's hook up again and just see if there's anything there.
Yeah.
Worthy. I think he'd go there just to try it out. In the long term,
but absolutely. All right, good stuff. Head.
So, for your eyes only, then, what do we think here?
I think Melina is too damn angry. Like she's boiling white hot rage, isn't she? And I feel like she's too preoccupied with revenge. Even once, yeah, she's taken revenge, like I feel after that she'd still be a very dark human being. She'd still be very like, do you know what I mean? Yeah. She'd be just wanting to fight all the time, and yeah, I can't see that working out.
Which potentially has its advantages on occasion, but not for...
well, there you go. Yeah, indeed. But yeah, I don't know. With Roger's happy-go-lucky nature,
no, that's true.
I don't see, yeah, that working, no, all that well.
Definitely not.
Right. You would get to the point where you'd be like, just yeah, chill out, love, all right?
Yeah, yeah, yeah,
you know what,
yeah,
I mean? Yeah, it's, yeah, just, let's put the past in the past and let's just enjoy, yeah, ourselves.
Yeah, that's it. I think he'd turn to the drink in that relationship.
Yeah, yeah.
a bit too heavily.
And she'd always be getting her crossbow out when she's got the ump and stuff. Do you know what I mean?
BB was way too young, so we can get rid of her. But Countess Liesel, now, it's a very short moment. Don't forget, after one night, they're holding hands, walking, yeah, down the beach, Tom. I think that's, there's true, definite potential that if she had survived, that Bond and Countess Liesel, there could have been a bit more going on there.
Yeah, that's a good point. I could see them together for sure. Yeah, absolutely. Yeah. It would be nice to hear more of her backstory, actually, wouldn't it? To see that stuff, obviously. But yeah,
she knows that sort of world, doesn't she? If she's mates with Columbo and stuff like that.
Yeah.
Obviously, it was only a one night thing, but I think Bond would definitely have gone back there to try it out, sample it a bit more, and see what happens.
Absolutely, good stuff. Now, Chris.
Yes.
Octopussy. I think that's the magical conundrum. Conundrum?
Yes.
That's not what I was
conundrum?
Trying to say.
No.
The magical combination is what I was trying, yes, to say there. Another C word. I feel like Bond has got, you know, the turbulent childhood, the sort of, can you imagine Bond as a teenager? He'd have been a right tear away, not listening, yeah, to, you know, anybody's thoughts and all the rest of it. He'd have been carving his own way and all that kind of stuff. A bit of a rebel, I would say.
A bit of a rebel.
Which obviously he still is. He likes to go rogue every film lately. He likes to do that.
Yeah, he does.
So there's that. And then obviously you've got Octopussy as well, which she has an equally tumultuous backstory as well. So I feel like they're sort of different sides of a similar coin almost. Do you know what I mean? I feel like
equally, you could say, yeah, they're two of a kind.
You could, couldn't you? Absolutely. You could.
Yeah.
Yes.
Yeah.
So I could really see that. I feel like I feel like they
great chemistry as well. Yeah, great chemistry.
Weird how I didn't get that with Miss Anders, but I do with Octopussy. Yeah.
Yeah, exactly. Well, it's that character, it's that backstory. They both know what each other do. They both sort of do stuff which is beyond the law type thing.
Yeah.
They both can appreciate each other's skills and abilities. For me, obviously, we'll come back to this in a moment, but that's a definite potential. I think with Magda, you'd happily revisit that, wouldn't you?
Yes, you would. Indeed, you would. The thing is, the freaky thing about Magda is her little black book, isn't it? With all of
the scrapbook.
All of
her,
yeah, the scrapbook.
Would that make you jealous? Would you like fish it out and say, right,
it wouldn't be so much that. It would be if you're the sort of person who keeps that scrapbook and that's something that you do, they're on the one side of the coin, she's going to be up for some grottiness, isn't she? Nice. Let's enjoy that. But as a partner in life,
he'd
be like, hold on a minute, what's this bird capable of? Do you know what
that's
I mean? I feel like there'd be some darkness there that might get out of control. Do you know what I mean?
And also, you would want to check just to see what page number you came in on.
Because
if you're like page 184, you'd be like,
you might need a trip to the clinic or whatever, wouldn't you? Do you know what I mean?
That's it, definitely.
Absolutely.
Get cleaned up. So I think you're right. Just the one night maybe for that one. But there we go.
Absolutely.
Okay, AvTac, what do we think? We've got Stacey Sutton and Pola Ivanova.
Stacey Sutton, never in a million years. I don't think that...
Mate, I couldn't last... not in that way.
Well, what way are you talking about, Chris? Goodness gracious me.
Both ways, I think, maybe. I don't know. She's...
Yes. right. That's it. You just revealed yourself as a two-pump Johnny right there. So there's yes. So I don't feel like there's much real chemistry there. I think it's a pump.
She'd just
dump
scream your name in bed and you'd be like, oh, fucking shut up, wouldn't you?
Just be quiet. Like, I mean, she is absolutely stunning to look at. Absolutely. Like Michael Connell said, those sort of glassy blue eyes.
She has got lovely eyes.
I can't see them working for some reason. It's just a gut feeling. I just don't think that's going to work out. Pola Ivanova, I would say, I'll put her in the same box as Triple X. Like when they meet up on missions, their paths cross, they'll have a little slap and tickle. But as a long-term partner, I can't see that really working.
And the obvious winner from the whole thing then is Mayday.
Yes, absolutely. Now that is a different one. Yeah, I could see that working for sure. Yes, goodness gracious me.
And they got on so well. So
I think this one's a bit of a shoe-in, to be honest.
Yeah, I'd say without a doubt. Go for it.
Yeah, I would say the one person he would settle down with, Rogers Bond, would be Octopussy. I think that could
definitely
work as a long-term thing.
Yeah, I think the honourable mention would go to Countess Liesel, in my opinion, as a potential, as the best potential out of the rest. But I think definitely Octopussy is the one that I think he'd settle down with as well.
Cool. Sounds
good. So there we go. That's
all right then. So the final category of the day, Chris, is the climax. The best climaxes from Roger's films. That was a very Roger response from me there. Ooh. And the villain's death as well. So kind of combining the two into one there. So let's go back to Live and Let Die, obviously. How do you feel about Kananga's passing?
Okay, so we've got Kananga's underground lair. So we've got the classic villain underground lair. Yeah. Shark pool. Yeah, the voodoo ceremony's kind of up top. We've got the shark pool. We've got the luring cage. We've got that sort of fight with Kananga. You know, he's got the knife and everything like that. And obviously, we've got the compressed air bullet, which Kananga swallows and inflates and explodes. So there's a lot going on. I think in terms of a villain's lair, it's classic underground lair. There's not a lot else going on. It's got a monorail, to transport the drugs, which obviously you get bonus points for that. I think the fight between Bond and Kananga is pretty decent in terms of like an end of villain fight. You know, they both get involved with the knife and all that sort of weird movement and stuff. In terms of the way that the send off with the inflatable thing, I mean, it is crazy, isn't it? It's absolutely comic booky and it looks a bit mad, but I still kind of like it. We see the sofa blow up early on. So again, like we said, foreshadowing a little bit, and we see the same thing happen to Kananga. So I don't know. What do you think then?
I think Kananga's death is equal parts brilliant and ridiculous. It's like, yeah, it's silly and funny at the same time as just being sort of weirdly brilliant, because it's a Rogers villain, and you sort of that, you kind of get away with that. Yes, it's a good way for him to go. I think ultimately, if you're going to do it a serious way, he wouldn't inflate. He would just sort of explode from the inside, and his guts would fly everywhere. Yeah. But maybe that was a bit graphic for the times. But that's kind of what you would do. It would be like an alien moment where his belly just expands and then just blows out. But the inflatable. Ooh,
that's an interesting thing on it.
But okay. Next up then, we got Man with the Golden Gun, the duel with the Scaramanga. So what do you think about that? Mano y mano, my golden gun versus your water PPK.
I only need the one. This is pretty cool. Again, we're talking about the fun house, so that whole setup. Where have you seen that before? It's like original, isn't it? It is kind of crazy. The actual duel is interesting because obviously Scaramanga Scarpers, you don't know where he is. Bond goes looking for him. We know Scaramanga's only got one bullet, or at least supposedly. I find it kind of an interesting watch, but I do think that the whole fact that you see the mannequin at the start, now I don't know if I had that in my head when I was like 5 or 4 when I first watched it, that, oh God, Bond's going to be there as a mannequin at the end. Or obviously I've seen it so many times since. But maybe that bit is a bit too much of a giveaway as to what's going to happen. But I think it's still a really cool scene and stuff like that. I don't know. What's your opinion?
I think what's interesting about that is the whole mano a mano thing. If like two equals going against each other, I think I love that. Yeah. And I would kind of like to see that done again. In a modern setting, not as particularly Scaramanga, but just like another 00 that goes rogue or something like that. Maybe not as obvious as that, but like somebody who's matches Bond in every way, going head to head like that. That would be interesting to see. And I like the fact that Scaramanga has the edge, because even though Bond's got more bullets, Scaramanga only needs one, and he's 100% confident of that as well. So I think that's a really nice thing. Obviously, the moment where Scaramanga is dispatched, I think that's like a, you know, like we often say about being hoisted by their own petard, it's like that's perfect, isn't it? There he is with his mannequin. Whether it's too much of a giveaway or not from seeing the thing, I don't know, but it's what I really like about it is that Bond gets him right between the eyes. Like, that's a great shot. Who's the best fucking shot in the world? It's not you anymore, Scaramanga. Have it between the eyes. Yeah.
Do you think it would have worked if, you know, there's that whole thing that Scaramanga actually did have a second bullet behind his belt?
Mm.
And the fact that he only had one in the film meant that he couldn't fire. Because basically that meant that was the thing over.
Yeah.
Do you think it would have worked if he actually had two and he shot one and that one bullet actually caught Bond? Obviously it didn't kill him, but it caught him in some way. And then he obviously reloaded with a second one, but Bond got him before. Or do you think that wouldn't have worked?
I think, because you can see that in one of the trailers, can't you? With one of the early trailers, there's that sequence when they do the back-to-back, you know, whatever that is, the dual walk-off kind of thing.
Yeah.
In the basically what happens is you would see Scaramanga run off and hide behind a rock. That's and right. And then you can see, like, what is it? Doesn't he throw something up and shoot it or something? I think
Bond there's a thermos bomb. There's a thermos bomb, but that's with a different gun. He uses a different gun to do that.
Oh, is it? Okay.
And not his golden gun. Yeah,
whatever it is, basically, there's a thing where Scaramanga fires more than once, and Bond says to him, "Now I know how you do it, Scaramanga." And there's the whole thing that it's not really one shot. He just basically cheats. To me, that cheapens Scaramanga, and I think I don't want that. I want him to just have the one shot and be that bloody good. Do you know what I mean? I think I agree. His skill being cheated by that.
No, I agree. I absolutely agree, actually. So there we go. Cool. Okay, so on to Spy. So Spy, we kind of got this big, massive shootout on the Leparis, like massive, the classic group baddies against goodies. And obviously we've got the Atlantis with the rescue of Anya. The fight with Jaws, obviously with Stromberg on the long table with a harpoon gun, and he shoots him. Do we need to mention Nick Knack and in from Golden Gun on the little fight in the junk or not? I mean, it's kind of like the aftermath, isn't it?
It's a bit of a sort of throwaway moment after the sort of thing is finished, isn't it? The main kind of bulk of it. But yeah, it's worth an honorable mention, I suppose.
Cool. So Spy, what do you think of Spy?
Spy is a tricky one, isn't it? One of the things I noticed actually from the All Night Bond marathon is a lot of people were saying that Spy really slows down by the time you get to the tanker sequence, which I must say I haven't noticed that before, but maybe in that setting when you're watching them back to back, maybe those things become more glaringly obvious. I don't know. But yeah, so there's that. I think Stromberg's death is very underwhelming, isn't it? You know what I mean? Yeah. It's just basically it's a gunshot to the chest.
Yeah.
I feel like you could have at least chucked him down the hole in the lift or whatever, and he could have been eaten by the shark or something. Something with a bit more flavor to it than just a
something
simple
related
gunshot.
To water as well. It happened. Yeah. You know, it would have been better. Yeah. But
that would have been nice. Yeah. Obviously you got the Jaws fight thrown in as well. Jaws gets hoisted by his own petard with his magnetic teeth, doesn't he? So
which
that's,
is great.
That's a
I
nice
love that.
Little touch.
Yeah. How does that grab you?
Indeed, very nice. Drax's space station. That's a classic hoist by his own petard moment, isn't it? Getting sucked out into space. What do you think about that whole climax?
I mean, what a crazy way to go in terms of the actual space station, the big battle. When it's on the space station itself, I kind of don't mind it. You know, they've got the lasers going and you know, the Drax's guys in yellow and then the US astronaut Marines in white. Mm-hmm. But the whole space laser battle outside, I'm a bit like, I'm not sure about that. That's really good. But everything inside is pretty decent. And then the actual bit with Drax, I really like. He's like, desolated Mr. Bond. Heartbroken Mr. Drax. And obviously, he's about to kill him and then he uses the wrist dart gun. And then, obviously, what a perfect send-off, isn't it? Sending him out into space and yeah, great way to go. So in terms of that film, I think it works really well.
Very nice. For your eyes only, you got St. Cyril's Monastery. Now, I tell you what, man, that climbing sequence is great. I love that. And I love the sneaky stealth sort of assault on it. I think that's brilliant. What do you think about the actual sort of like death of Christatos and the actual sort of like last scenes of the actual film?
Yeah, so I mean... I'm not sure. I mean, I love the whole, there's, you know, five of them and five men and one woman, and they go on and it's kind of World War II, like we've got the basket going up, you know, they get the guards and stuff like that. And I like all that. And then there's a bit of a fight going on, which is not too bad. And they're chasing Christatos with the ATAC and stuff. But the ending, I'm not sure. I like the bit with Golgo and the whole detente comrade and stuff like that. I think is great. But the way that Christatos dies from Columbo, I still don't know whether it would have been better if Melina was the one to do it, to avenge her parents or not.
I definitely think crossbow to the ball back should have been the way for him to go. Do you know what I mean?
Yeah.
Like really let her get that vengeance. I think that would have been nice.
Yeah. So ideally, I probably would have gone for it that way around.
Because I feel like her arc is a little bit of a disappointment, because you have all this build-up of her being this scorned woman with a crossbow who goes around killing. And I feel like... what you would have done is, you know, crossbow into the eyeball, and then her finally feeling that release of, I've done it, and now it's okay, I can move on.
Because, you know, in Thunderball, obviously they let Domino harpoons Largo, doesn't he? And it's almost like, I don't know if they thought that having Melina kill Christatos in cold blood made her a bad person, which obviously is not good to kill someone, almost it weakens her character a little bit by not giving her that opportunity, I think, personally, anyway.
And I feel just looking, because Domino was very much a sort of, you know, a damsel, wasn't she? She was a damsel in distress, whereas Melina was like taking the bull by the horns. And I feel like you look at those deadly eyes of hers, man, when she glares into the camera at the beginning and stuff, you know what I mean? It's like, man, if there was a woman who was capable of seeking revenge and getting it, it was her. I do think that was a missed opportunity, actually. She should definitely have been the one to do it.
Alternatively, once Columbo sort of stabbed Christatos, she could have just gone on and like kicked him up the bum and go, huh.
And then
do that.
That would have been very nice. Yeah, I like it. Yeah. Screw Purvis and Wade, mate. They should get you in for Bond 25. Love it. Moving on for Octopussy, then we've got the assault on the the air balloon assault, as I like to often call it. I suppose there's a lot going on here. You've got the main sort of climax is the plane fight, which I have to say. That stunt work is incredible. When you see that dude who was actually up there on that plane, just hanging on for dear life,
two of them.
Mate, that's incredible. Well, yeah, two of them obviously, yeah. But like that, yeah. That man is a mind blowing stunt work. Do you imagine like the being up on that flimsy little plane that high with doing all that stuff? That's an incredible bit of filmage there.
Yeah, I'm a big fan of this. I actually really like the whole fight as well with the sort of gymnastic octopussy girls. You know, using their skills and abilities against. You know, obviously Khan's men and stuff like that. I think that's all cool. Octopussy going up on that big pole and then and that whole thing I think is good. But the plane thing is brilliant. So obviously Bond on the horse as it's about to take off, obviously leaps on the tail, it goes up, and just visually it's so stunning. Yeah. And you've got the whole out there and that sort of thing is like
and get it. Yeah, get it. Out there. Yeah.
And that's just brilliant. I would say though that Khan's death is a little bit underwhelming. Like I know he sort of dies in the plane crash, and that's good. But Bond doesn't get to say a one liner about it, and I know it probably wouldn't have worked if he did.
I almost feel like Bond could have swooped into the plane, pulled him from the controls, and chucked him out the door. That might have been enough. And you could add the Wilhelm scream as he plans to do that. I tell you what, though, I do like the way how that ends as the plane goes over the edge and they just like dive off at the last minute and catch onto the edge of the cliff. Yeah. That's kind of nice. Yeah. I like that.
That is good. Yeah, that is cool. Cool. Okay, on to Avtak then. So we've got, again, kind of two sequences. We've got the mine with all the miners being shot by Zorin and Scarpine. And then eventually, obviously, we've got the air blimp with Bond hanging on the mooring rope going towards the Golden Gate Bridge to try and rescue Stacey. So what do we think of Avtak?
Yeah, I mean, I think the mine sequence, going back to when it's being flooded and like Mayday is like stalking them throughout the mines, I think is a terrifying little sequence. And it's quite dark as well after it floods and Mayday's kind of turned and they go past Jenny Flex and she's like, Jenny! And you know what I mean? It's quite a dark moment, I think.
It is, you're right.
But going to the Golden Gate, I think, like we were saying before, like that's like a really frantic fight, you know? And I know, obviously, at this stage of the game, Roger's a lot older by this point and all that kind of stuff. But I kind of get that fight. It's not like when he's fighting the goons in Stacey's house where it's just a bit like, okay, it's a slow fight or down in the basement of the stables or whatever. Like for me, I feel like you get that sense of it being a frantic scramble for survival. And I think that comes across quite well. Yeah.
Yeah. And also I think in terms of like the mind sequence with Mayday blowing herself up to destroy Zorin's plan, how that's iconic in itself. How amazing is that scene? That's so good. And the Golden Gate Bridge, again, that is iconic. Being on top of that, seeing like the water like way, way below. And it's just like, I think it's great. Yeah. So I'm a big fan. Okay, so here comes the tricky question then.
Go on, Em.
What do you think is the best? Okay, I guess we'll have two answers to this. So the best villain death out of the Roger Moore series and the best sort of climactic battle. Okay, so what do you think for those?
I would say, this is a tough one, actually. I would say the best villain's death.
Oh, I've got two for that one.
I do think Zorin's death is great. Yeah. That's a really good one. I like that. Yeah. That's really nice. I also do like Scaramanga's death as well. That's a good way for him to go. In terms of sort of climax sequence, I would say it's a tough one. I think
it is very tough.
It is a tough one to choose. I think, do you know what? I'm doubling up on Golden Gun. I'm saying the Funhouse. I really like that. And I really like Scaramanga's death at the end of that as well. So I'm doubling up on that. What about you?
Okay, nice one. My villain's death was either going to be Drax or Zorin, but I'm going to go with Zorin. Yeah. So my villain's death is going to be Zorin. I think it's just amazing. That little smile, that little chuckle that he does just as he knows his game's up when he slips is just brilliant. It's fantastic. Yeah. So that would be my answer. In terms of best climactic battle, it's tricky.
It is tricky because there's a lot of things I like about different ones. It's difficult to sort of, for different reasons as well.
Yeah, like Spy in terms of the Laparis, that's kind of like a classic battle scene. And then you've got Atlantis and Jaws, which is pretty cool. Space Station, the Monastery is good because it's kind of old Cold War, World War II style sort of thing. Yeah. I like the Octopussy battle and the thing. And then you've got the mine as well. Oh, mate, I don't know if I can choose one. Okay, I'm going to go with... I'm going to double up on the View to a Kill. I'm going to go with the Line and the Bridge.
Very nice. All right, cool stuff.
Yeah, or Octopus.
No, you've already chosen. Too late. Game over. All right. Cool. Okay, so there we have it, there, Chris. We've done it. We've got through all the categories. Excellent stuff. So that is the end of the Roger Moore period of Bond. We've been studying it for 2 years now, can you believe? Good God. Blimey. 2 whole years of Bond studage, of Roger studage. Roger studage. What a wonderful time it's been as well. So I suppose we should send him off, shouldn't we, with some various other talking points. Yeah. So obviously we've got like some of his films during Bond, post Bond, and some more Sir Roger Bond facts as well. So why don't you kick us off with some Roger film chat?
Okay, so I know you, I'm not sure if you've seen any of these, but he did quite a few good films during his Bond tenure that weren't Bond as well. I think you've seen Cannonball Run, haven't you? That's just so much fun, that. Yeah. I watched Sherlock Holmes in New York for the first time the other week, and it's not bad. To be honest, it's not amazing, but it's still pretty cool, and he is good in it. And the fact that Patrick McNee is Watson, and that's really nice to see. That's so cool. That was really good. Gold, I haven't seen. That's going to be good. But Wild Geese, if you get a chance to see that, that's a really cool film. Wild Geese.
Very nice.
When was
North Sea Hijack? That's a cracking film. I like that one.
That was around that sort of time as well, I think. Because he did Sea Wolves as well, I think. Yeah, have a look. It's got to be around that sort of time. North Sea Hijack. I haven't seen that one actually. Is that
1980? 1980. Oh, there we go. Yeah, so. That's a beauty. That one. I enjoy that. Yeah.
Oh, I'll have to find that. I'll have to dig that up because I haven't seen that one.
Yeah.
And then I suppose looking at the films post Bond, he had a cameo in The Saint, the movie. He was in Spice World, Tom. Spice World.
Yeah, I remember that.
Of all things. He also did. I know I didn't know this, but he did a short film called The Fly Who Loved Me, and apparently he did voiceover work for that. And this thing called Boat Trip, which was like so hilarious.
Where he filleted a sausage.
Yes, indeed. But the one film on there which I watched for the first time last week was Fire, Ice, and Dynamite, directed by Willy Bogner. Now this film, Tom, I almost felt like I was tripping when I watched it. It's mental. It's loopy loo, but really? In a kind of a cool way. So he's like this multi-millionaire, and he kills himself, supposedly commits suicide, and puts his estate, like $135 million, up for grabs, whoever can win this contest. And it's basically, you know, it is just once the tournament starts, it's just a whole load of like crazy stunts. So people are snowboarding and skiing down sort of mountains of gravel. They're like going canoeing with like two canoes on their feet. I saw the bungee jump at Verdasca Dam. They're doing that. Nice. They're climbing up it and someone bungee jumps off it. There's like just loads of crazy stuff. And basically it's all these different groups of teams, and they're all got different sponsors. But they're really weird. So like there's a German team and all they do is drink beer. So whenever they're like performing one of the challenges, they're like drinking beer at the same time. And then you've got these two people that are trying to stop. So Roger's son is in it. So Jeffrey Moore is in it. And he's like one of the family team that gets to inherit the money if his team win. And there are these two people that are trying to stop them. It's mental. It really is crazy. And I almost felt like, if you're going into it thinking this is going to be mental, then yeah, it is worth watching.
So would you rank it alongside Casino Royale 67 as just a bit of an oddity that's worth a watch out of curiosity?
I think so. I think the stunt work's amazing. It's still brilliant compared to a lot of things that you see nowadays. Yeah. But I was watching it and like every 2 seconds I was going, what? You know, just because what I was watching was mental. But it was great. It was very good.
Yeah. I'd say there's another one as well, post-Bond. I think it was called The Quest with Van Damme, Jean-Claude Van Damme. Did you ever see that
one? Was he in that? I'm sure I must have done, because I went through a Van Damme stage back in my days. But,
I remember seeing that a long time ago. The Quest was, I feel like it was maybe around 2000s. Let me see. The Quest, Van Damme, The Quest. 1996 it was. Yeah.
Wow, he
was
okay. In that. That's got to be one of his...
Taken in by the mysterious Lord Dobbs, Roger Moore, as the boat docks in Thailand, Dubois is introduced to the underground world of martial arts fighting. There you go.
Sounds Lord like Dubois. All the other Van Damme
films. Yes, it does indeed. Cool stuff. Right, cool. Then, so sum it up for me, Chris.
Yes.
Sum it up. Sum up Roger's tenure as Bond. How do you feel? Because, like we said, we try and watch these films through for the podcast with fresh eyes, fresh brain, try and put ourselves there back in the time when they were released and all that kind of stuff. Get rid of all the typical baggage that the Bond films have and just try and accept it as its own piece and all that kind of stuff. So how has that been for you? How has the whole process studying the Bond films of Sir Roger been?
Yeah. I think the only way to sum it up would be, ooh.
Very nice. I like it. Ooh.
Yeah. We've mentioned it before in the other ones. It's been great. 2 years of Sir Roger. Fantastic. But with something you mentioned earlier in this podcast, he and his films do get overlooked sometimes, as potentially some people say he's second-rate Bond. But that's totally not the case. Look at everything we've listed, some of the most iconic scenes, memorable moments, and such a breadth in terms of the range of Bond. We do see a bit of dark and gritty. We definitely see fantastical. We get some great humour as well. And we get probably the most coolest, suave moments in the series with Sir Roger. Yeah. So big, big, big fan and really enjoyed it. And it's hard to know when he was definitely at his peak. I remember him... In Spy, he looks amazing. Yeah. I think, you know, overall, I think he's, you know, 7 Bond films, just unreal. And, it's just a great sort of time with Bond, I think, with those 7 films.
Yeah, absolutely. I think for me, like I always said, it was like I was always least familiar with those last 3, maybe the last 2, because I watched For Your Eyes Only loads as a kid. So those last 2, the ones I just, for whatever reason, didn't watch as often. So go on, you're going to say something.
Yeah, no, I was going to say this is interesting now. So how are those?
I tell you what, because remember the story about For Your Eyes Only, I watched it so much as a kid, I knew it inside out. And because of that, I didn't watch it for years to just try and, you know, when you know something so well, you're like, do you know what? I need to just give that a rest for, you know, a long time. Yeah. I'm talking probably best part of 10 years. I was like, do you know what? Wow. I'm just going to not watch that. Just to let some of that stuff just sort of like get, you know, leave my brain and sort of revisit later and stuff. And I think that for me has been the one I've enjoyed reviewing the most, in the sense of like rediscovering it. And it was sort of brought back a lot of those memories of being a kid and seeing it when I was young and all that kind of stuff. And I think for me, that one is considerably, out of all the others, gone up in my estimations than what I thought about it previously from getting That's through cool. from it from the podcast. Yeah, it's definitely a favorite. It's Live and Let Die is still my favorite. Love that one. But yeah, For Your Eyes Only is definitely right up there as well. But again, I don't want to rank them in order, because it sort of unfairly puts some things in a box without really achieving anything. So I love it. It's good. It's been great.
In terms of sort of the Roger Moore films, which I've kind of, I don't think they've sort of changed in my perspective as much as perhaps they might have done. But in terms of a film that has garnered more respect for me, I think it's actually been A View to a Kill, because there's a segment which I'm not keen on, which is the fire truck scene and everything around that. But taking that to one side, I really enjoy the rest of the film. I think it's great. And and it's generally at the bottom of people's list, like a hell of a lot. Yeah. You see it way down there, but there's so much in it. Like, obviously we reviewed it recently, but Zorian, Mayday, so many iconic scenes, moments. I know Roger, the age thing, but, you know, for me, A View to a Kill's got so much going for it. And that's really been the one that's kind of, you know, gone up. For me too, actually,
because that is one, like I say, I just, for whatever reason, haven't watched it as much as the others and all the rest of it. And I think, it's a weird one, because obviously it does have its various problems and things that could have been done a little bit better or done a bit differently, maybe. Fire truck sequence is a perfect example of that. And all that kind of stuff. But there is so much to enjoy about that. And I think, I don't know, I think some say that we're a little bit too positive of certain things with Bond and all that. But at the same time, I don't think we are. I think it's more of just like appreciating the good things and not letting the negative outweigh the good. Yeah, because exactly. What's the point of dwelling on the negative side of things when there's something you can enjoy in there? Do you know what I mean? Exactly. I think that's my sort of motto with it. And there is a heck of a lot, like we were saying, I mean, obviously we've reviewed it, but, you know, even just Zorin and Mayday, what an amazing double team they are and stuff. And some of those visuals with the blimp and all that kind of stuff. And that score is amazing. It's a great one. It really is. And like we said, it's kind of, once we reviewed it, so many people came out of the woodwork and were like, I love this film. And like, you know, really singing its praises and stuff. So yeah, game on. That's what I say. Bring it on.
There we go. Cool. Okay, so time for some 007 Bond facts with Sir Roger. Okay, so Bond fact number one, Sir Roger was made a Commander of the Order of the British Empire in 1999 and received his knighthood in 2003.
Rightly deserved as well.
Yeah, definitely. Bond fact number two, Sir Roger was made a UNICEF Goodwill Ambassador in 1999 and provided the voice of Father Christmas, or Santa, in the 2004 UNICEF cartoon The Fly Who Loved Me. Bomb fact number three, in 2007, Sir Roger received a star on the Hollywood Walk of Fame, and it's located at 7007 Hollywood Boulevard. That's pretty cool.
Very nice. That is cool.
Bomb fact number four, in 2010, Moore provided the voice of a talking cat called Lazenby in the film Cats and Dogs, The Revenge of Kitty Galore, which contains several references and parodies of Bond films. That's pretty cool, isn't it? A cat called Lazenby.
Yeah.
Yeah. I haven't actually seen that one, but I have to check it out. Bond fact number five. Sir Roger was named one of GQ's 50 best dressed men in 2015. Now, for a man of his years, that's a great accolade.
Absolutely.
Really,
the old double-breasted blazer with the brass buttons. Absolutely. You cannot go wrong with that. Yeah.
Definitely not. When are we going to rock that, man, by the way?
We're not ready for it yet, Chris, but when we are ready, it's going to come.
We will know.
Believe me.
We will know. Okay, wicked. Okay, so bomb fact number six. So Roger has been married four times to Dawn Van Stern in 1946, Dorothy Squires in 52, Louisa Mattioli in 69, and to Christina Kiki Thulstrup in 2002, obviously, who he's still currently married to, which is great. And
obviously
finally,
a glutton for punishment, that one.
Well, he is, four times, wow. And finally, Bond fact 007, Sir Roger has authored four books to date. He has authored Roger Moore as James Bond, Roger Moore's Own Account of Fleming, Live and Let Die. Now, this is one I really recommend. It's not a long book,
say,
but it's
Own Account of Filming, Live and Let Die, not his Own Account of Fleming and Live and Let Die.
I beg your pardon. Yeah.
Sorry, carry on.
Filming is, I'm sure, yeah. And basically, it's like Sir Roger's diary while he made Live and Let Die. And it's only a small book, but you can pick it up on eBay for like a quid or £2 or whatever, next to nothing. And it's really, really, I just wish he'd done it for all the other films. But anyway, there we go. It's great. Obviously, he did My Word is My Bond, 2008. He did Bond on Bond, the ultimate book on 50 years of the Bond movies in 2012. And most recently, Last Man Standing, which is called One Lucky Bastard in the United States, which is interesting. And that was released in 2014. So well done, Roger. I wonder if we'll get any more.
Yeah, absolutely. I'm sure he's quite the prolific wordsmith these days. So you never know. I'm sure he's got some more stories tucked away. Absolutely.
I bet he has.
So, Chris, it's with a slightly heavy heart that we have to say goodbye to Sir Roger. We've given him two whole years, Chris. 2 years.
We have.
We gave Connery one. He only got 1 year back in the day when we only did 90-minute episodes. He got a year. Roger, however, has got double that. So, you know, we've given him his time. It's time to say, all right, thank you for that. Thank you for what you contributed to the world of Bond. And it's time to move on and get some Timmy D action on. So how are you feeling about where we are in the history of bondage right now with JBR, Chris? Are you excited?
Really?
Are you sad? Are you both?
I'm both. Definitely both. I'm sad, but a kind of a good sad, because I think we've definitely covered it.
Yes.
We've certainly covered it. You know, I don't think we need to do anything more. No. That bit has been done.
Yes.
And with a sad heart that we say goodbye, but equally it's the right time. And so that's fine. Really excited to get into Timmy D. Can't wait to review Living Daylights again. I love that film, particularly the first half. I think it's a cracker. Interesting, after what the JBR family said when they watched the old Bond marathon about that, so that'll be interesting. But you know, just to get a bit of fresh blood in, I think is great. And can't wait to get started on the next sort of era in terms of Bond actors.
Absolutely. Good stuff. All right, so goodbye, Sir Roger. Hello, Timmy D. Good stuff.
Here we go.
So then, I think it's time we should answer our listener trivia question of the day, which comes from Colin Peters. So should we have a little reminder of what that question was?
Let's do it.
Let's do it.
In which films do we actually see Felix Leiter shoot a gun?
Okay, then, Crispy Pants, what do you think? How many times have you seen Felix fire a gun? I've got one. I can't remember whether this is Bond or Felix, but I think you see Felix fire a gun at the sharks in Thunderball. Is that right or not?
Definitely.
Or
yes, he does. No, definitely he does. No, because he has to shoot one of the sharks when Bond goes down to find the Disco Volante, doesn't he? He's like, shoot one of them and keep the other sharks occupied while he goes down. So that's definitely one. He definitely fires a gun in the pre-titles of License to Kill as well. You know, when they go of to course. Sanchez's hideout and he's got the sort of machine gun type things, doesn't he?
Yeah.
So that's two. I'm trying to struggling to think of another. If that counts, if Never Say Never Again, do you remember in the climax when they're in that underground cave thing and Felix comes along, doesn't he? I know we reviewed that one ages ago, but I'm sure he shoots a gun in that one. If we're including Never Say Never, but I
think that's probably it though.
He has a gun obviously in most of them, but I don't think we see him use it in any others.
I don't think we see Jack Lord fire a gun, do we?
No.
All right then, so should we find out what the answer is?
Yeah, let's do it.
All right, let's do it.
Hey guys, it's Colin Peters calling back in for the answer to the trivia question I posed, which was, in which movies do we see Felix Leiter actually shoot a gun? And the answer is, in Thunderball, we see him shoot a harpoon at the shark when they're looking for the Vulcan. In License to Kill, we see Felix shooting at Sanchez and his men during the opening sequence. And also, if you consider Never Say Never Again part of the series, then we see Felix shooting in that in the cave near the end of the film. So there you have it. Thanks, guys, for all the work you do again. And we'll see you next time.
Well, we did pretty well, didn't we? Yeah, that was
not
nice.
Bad at all.
Cool stuff.
It's a good question as well, because it's another thinker. We like the thinkers, don't we?
Yeah, we certainly do. All right, cool. Now, Chris, next up, do you know what it's time for?
Go on, tell me.
It's time for the Guess the Quote Round.
Bond, 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 Bond. James Bond.
Excellent work. I'm loving how you mix things up lately with that theme tune. It's been good. Now, it was your quote last time, wasn't it? So
it
should we hear it again? Can you perform it for us one more time?
Yes, I will perform it again. And I think you were pretty solid on getting the answer to this. But my quote was... He wouldn't know a woman if one came up and sat on his head.
Okay, so that is GoldenEye.
It is GoldenEye. Do you know the scene or the character?
It's in Severnaya before it all kicks off, where Boris is misbehaving. And is it? I can't remember whether it's Natalia that says it or Natalia's mate that says it.
It's. I'll tell you what. It's Natalia's mate. But she does say her name in the scene. Any idea what it could be? Do you have a gut?
Is it Anna?
Yes! Yeah! Yes! Yes, man!
Look at that.
That's coming back from the GoldenEye mind.
It is. Absolutely.
That's so cool.
Good performance though, man. I'm impressed with that. Yeah. That's come along very nicely. I've got a little bit of a doozy for you this week, Chris.
Oh, what? Well, okay,
I'm sure you'll get it. My quote of the week is...
Yep.
You underestimated him.
Oh, shit. Wait a minute. Let's think. Can you do that again?
You underestimated him.
There's something there, but I haven't got it straight away. I haven't got it straight away. No, I'm going to have to think about that one. Oh, that's a good one, Tommy.
Good stuff.
That is a good one.
Okay, then turning it over to the listeners then, we got a listener quote from Chris Marshall last time, didn't we? So should we have a little listen to that and remind ourselves what that was?
Yeah, let's have a listen.
You have slight lesions in the upper vertebrae.
So that is an outstanding performance. I think nobody on planet Earth would have any questions about who is actually delivering that line. That's absolutely great. But the question is obviously, what film is this from? So I've got a solid idea. Have you got a solid idea?
Definitely. Yeah, brilliant performance, Chris. Definitely got a good idea. Can you tell me what scene it is?
Yes. Okay.
Go for it.
It's Never Say Never Again.
Yep, that's what I thought.
And it's where Bond sneaks in and does the super creepy massage on Kim Basinger.
Super creepy. That's what I think as well.
Yes, yeah.
Should we have a listen? Let's see if we're
See if we're right.
Good afternoon, JBR. This is Chris again with my follow-up answer to my previously submitted listener quote. And that quote was spoken by, of course, Sean Connery in Never Say Never Again, specifically the massage parlor scene with Kim Basinger.
Excellent stuff. We did pretty well there, didn't we? We've been on a bit of a roll today.
Nice one. Yeah, we're doing all right. So we've got a new listener quote this week, and this is from Mr. Martin Bell. Should we have a listen?
Yeah.
Hi, everyone. This is Martin Bell calling in from London. I've wanted to leave a quote for quite a while. Here's hoping that this one hasn't been used just yet. This is my quote. Oh, good. There's a train coming. Once again. Oh, good. There's a train coming. Thank you guys for everything that you do. Lately, you've been keeping me entertained on very long car journeys, and that's no easy task. Catch you later.
Cool. Well, thank you for that one, Martin. I'm quietly confident on that one. Yes.
You're looking at it.
Yeah, yeah, I'm quietly confident. It's my brain that you might have just referred to recently kicking in again, I think. Yeah. But good stuff. Happy nice that we're entertaining you on long car journeys, Martin. Good stuff. Yep. Excellent. So, you know what it's time for now, don't you, Chris?
I do. It's time for...
Who wrote the song? Die. Who played Helga Branton? How did she die? Who wants to stop while the water in the Nivea? It's Tommy Trivia.
That's right. It's time for Tommy Trivia, where Chris breaks out a card from the 007 Trivial Pursuit deck and quizzes me on them to see how I fare. So what have you got for me this week, Chris?
Okay, so this week, Tom, we're going to start with... crew and behind the scenes. Okay, so first question, who sings the title song? That was, who sings the title song?
Gee, I don't know.
Okay, who sings the title song to GoldenEye?
That would be Tina Turner.
Shall I check, just in
case? Yeah, go on, have a double check, okay. Just in case.
Tina Turner, well there done. Okay, one out of one. We are now on to casting characters. Who does Julian Glover play?
Christatos.
Yes, and for a bonus point or a slap on the back, what's his first name?
Aris.
Yes, good man, good man. Or as BB likes to say, Uncle Ari.
Yeah.
Okay, on to the films. Helga Brandt is a Spectre agent. But what number is she?
Oh, shit. This is a good one.
This is a good one.
Oh, man, that's tough. Is she number
three? I can come back to it. I'll come back to it.
I'm going to have a guess. Is it number three? Okay. Number three or six, I think, one of those
two. It's not number three. It's not number six.
Fuck it, then. What is it?
Number 11.
Is she? Of course, I can hear him say it now, number 11.
Number 11. Yes. Yeah,
oh, no, I'm hearing the Thunderball one say number 11 during the... Yeah. The Latin America drug dealing sequence.
She does get called number 11 when they're called up to Blofeld. So before she gets piranha'd, shall
right,
we say.
Yeah. All right, cool. Nice one.
Tough one. Okay, so on to vehicles. What destroys the Antonov?
What destroys the Antonov? That's Octopus, isn't it? Antonov, the Antonov star?
No, that's the Romanov star.
Romanov star, shit.
Yeah. The Antonov is the plane in Die Another Day. So what destroys Antonov in Die Another Day?
No wonder I didn't do it. The plane. What destroys the plane?
Do you remember?
It's been so long. Is it that big space laser thing?
Do you remember what it's called?
The Icarus.
Yes, I think it's that. Let me check. The Icarus Space Mirror. There we go. Well done. You got a question right for Die Another Day, Tom. Amazing.
Yeah, I did, didn't I?
Okay, Two more questions to go. We're on to gadgets and weapons. What is a plastic explosive disguised as in License to Kill?
Toothpaste.
Yes. And for a bonus point or a slap on the back, do you know what brand of toothpaste?
Dentonite.
Yes, Tom. Excellent stuff. Okay. Final question here we've got is locations. What, oh God, you got this straight away. What area of California does Zorin want to flood?
That would be Silicon Valley.
Superb, Mr. Bond. Superb. That's excellent. So basically, it was only one that you didn't get. Brilliant stuff, Tom. Good, lovely. Good round.
Tommy, all right, cool. Next up, it's time for...
It's the music cue.
That's right. It's time for Guess the Music Cue, where Chris gives us a little tiny snippet of music. We've got to guess what scene it's from. So should we have a listen to last week's one?
Let's do it. Let's have a listen.
All right.
You're nodding very confidently, yep, there, Tom.
I think that is You Only Live Twice.
It is You Only Live Twice.
And okay. I think it's during his funeral at sea.
Absolutely spot on, my friend. Spot on. Superb. Excellent stuff.
Beautiful, yeah, stuff.
So it's just the point where the guy's giving the speech before the thing actually goes into the water, before his body goes into water. Superb, spot on.
Very nice.
Okay, so I've got another music cue for you this week. Now, this one, I think you're going to get like within half a second, but we haven't had this one for a while, so I thought, why the hell not? Should we have a listen?
Let's do it.
Okay. Okay, Tom, so there we go. What do you think of that one?
I've got it. I know it. Yes, for a moment there where my brain scrambled, but of course I know what it is. Yeah, that's a good one. I know one of our listeners will know what that one is too.
Yes.
Shall remain nameless for obvious reasons.
Yes.
Excellent stuff. Now, last time we had a rather gnarly, naughty little question from Warren Ringham about the 007 theme. So let's just have a little reminder what that question was.
Obviously, the 007 theme, John Barry's 007 theme, has been used quite a few times across five films. So I thought, what about if you have to guess which snippets come from which versions from the film? So what I'm looking for is the name of the films. Here we go then. This is the first clip. And here's clip number two. Quite a slow version, that one. Here's clip number three. That's quicker, that one. This is clip number four. Very fast, that one. Clip number five. And finally, clip number six.
All right, so that's a tricky one, isn't it? That is a tricky one. So I'm looking back at my notes from the last episode. I'm going to give you my rundown, and then let's see what your answers were. So I reckon the first one was You Only Live Twice. I reckon the second one was either Moonraker or Diamonds Are Forever, but I'm leaning towards Moonraker. I think the third one's Thunderbolt. Fourth one's Yolt, I think, again. And then the fifth one, I can't decide between Diamonds Are Forever and Moonraker, but I'm leaning towards Diamonds for that one. And then the last one, From Russia With Love. What do you think?
Okay, so my one, the first one I found tricky. The first one I thought was either Thunderbolt or From Russia. Second one, definitely Moonraker, I think. It's super slow. I think that's definitely Moonraker. The third one, I sounded like Russia. The fourth one I thought was Yolt, same as you. I thought the fifth one was Diamonds on the oil rig. And then the last one, like you, definitely Russia.
All right, then. So should we have a little listen to Warren's answer?
Yeah, let's do it.
Let's do it.
Hello, Tom and Chris. It's Warren speaking with the answer to the little bonanza Guess the Music cue that I provided for you last week. Now, the word on the vine I hear is that it was a little bit of a tricky one in the end. I didn't try to catch anybody out. I actually tried to give you little bits that would give you clues as to which ones they were. And I think you have to listen to all six first, and then you can kind of go back and piece together which ones are which. So, for example, the slowest one of the series is actually the Moonraker version. And then the fastest one in the series is the You Only Live Twice version. The 007 version from Russia With Love has a very unique sound. It's obviously that classic one that we probably know best. And then 007 Takes the Lecter actually has slightly different harmony in the but it's a little bit more clashy, so you can sort of tell that one apart. And then the other clue is Thunderball is the only one that actually has the breakdown at the start where it sort of starts and stops a few times. I think that's right anyway, but so here's the answers. So that one, of course, that's the breakdown bit that I was telling you about. It sort of starts and stops a few times. That's Thunderball. And there's that classic slow version for Moonraker. And that's the absolute classic original version that we love from 007 from Russia With Love. This one has quite a unique sound in the recording, I think, and that's, of course, You Only Live Twice. It's also the quickest one. This one's the most modern sounding one to me, and that's Diamonds Are Forever. And this is the one with the clashy harmony. 007 Takes the Lecter from Russia With Love. So there you go. That's the six. I hope you enjoyed it. Of course, Chris pointed out there is actually a seventh version because there's two versions in Thunderball. But there we go. Maybe I'll do another one of these sometime and see if I can catch you out again. Hope you're all well. Take care. Bye.
So there we have it, Chris. So looking back at my notes there, I got 4 out of 6. What did you get?
I got 5.
Well done. But excellent stuff.
I think the ones that, like, the standout ones are the ones where there's a difference in pace, or if they have, you know, like that From Russia one has this sort of cymbal in it, doesn't it? Which obviously none of the others have. The Moonraker one was super slow. But great question, though. Super difficult, but great question. Yeah,
absolutely. Yeah. Good stuff. Nice one, was it? Okay, then, Chris, next up, it's time for What's the Next Line? Very nice. This is somewhat like Guess the Quote for any new initiates, but it's the next line we're interested in, and that is the answer. You have to perform it in the style of which it's performed in the film. Now, I've got a good one for you, Chris. If you're on the ball, you're going to get this and you're going to nail it, right? But if you're anything like me, you're probably going to need a moment just to be like, hold on. Yeah. Oh, yeah, now I've got it, right?
Yeah.
Okay, so here we go. Are you ready for it?
I will try it, yeah.
Here's my line. Mr. Christopher Wright, what is the next line? In the conference room, something pretty big. Every 00 man in Europe's been rushed in, and the Home Secretary.
It's all right. He's probably lost a dog.
It's so close. Right. What is it?
Just lost a dog? No.
You got the last half right. I'm going to give it to you. Okay.
I only get a half mark. Sorry. I don't get the full mark. What is it?
I'm going to perform them both for you. So it's
okay.
In the conference room, something pretty big. Every 00 man in Europe's been rushed in, and the Home Secretary. His wife's probably lost a dog. So you've got it. It's his wife that lost the dog.
His wife. Oh, okay. Yeah. I knew it's something like that. Got the dog bit, but I get half then. I don't get full mark for that.
Lovely stuff.
Wicked, though. That is great. Great one.
All right. Next up, it's time for...
Bond Girl Battle!
Oh, James.
Yes, but my martini's still dry.
Very good. That's so a solid bad. Connery. That's almost as good as Chris Marshall's Connery. That's great. I like it. Congratulations.
Okay. Now, you know what, Tom? Normally, I would bust out the sombrero like I did here, like I did with a name call yesterday, and I'd get you to pick and choose. But we are down to the last three in the first round, so I don't need to do that. So I have got three Bond Girl cards in my hand. Are you ready to find out who they are?
I'm ready and waiting.
So the first one we have is dun dun dun, sexy Severine.
Oh, there goodness gracious me!
The beautiful Severine from Skyfall. Okay, next up we have. Oh my god, this is going to be so difficult. There isn't enough room for me and your ego. We have the amazing.
Oh my god! All right, okay.
Best Belinda.
Yeah.
Oh my god, this is tricky. Okay, and the third one is the last. Oh my fucking god! you wouldn't kill me. You'd miss me. The beautiful Electra King,
good.
Mate.
Chris,
that has got to be the toughest round.
To me, man? Oh,
that has got to be the toughest round going.
Oh.
We've got Severine, we've got Vesper Lind, and we've got Electra King. What?
Right. Okay, listen. We're going to have to rein things in, Chris, because this could easily get out of hand. This could easily get out of hand. And I think if it was a choice of, you know...
Plowing.
Who are you going to have a little bit of dippy-dippy fun with? Then I'm not sure I can answer. I would just be...
Let's just do that. Fuck the rules. Screw the rules. I want to know that more than the other. I want to know. That's more interesting to me. I want to know if there are three rooms and one of them was behind each door and you can only pick one door, what are you going to do? I want to know. That's more important right now. Who are you going to pick? Are you going to spend a night with Severine, Vesper Lynn, or Electra King? That's so difficult to choose. Oh my god.
Goodness gracious me. That we're gonna be here all day. I think I would just be wandering knob in hand
there'd be a
from
sneaky...
door to door, just weeping to myself. I just
there'd
would
be, there'd be like a sneaky side entrance into all three rooms and then that'd be happy
that would
days.
Be my entrance absolutely. I'd be like laser beam peace gloria.
I'm glad we're not doing it like the original way, because you just couldn't answer that, could you?
They'd all have to go through. Right, okay. Let's just gather ourselves for a moment.
Okay, Severine.
So who was the
Severine
first one?
Let's start with Severine.
Okay. is beautiful. Yes. Oh my
She's
goodness
lovely.
Gracious
yeah.
Strength of character. Let's see, what has she got? Go on, you lead the way on this one, because I'm just going to devolve into...
I think she's brave. She's obviously, in terms of like, she is a kept woman, really, isn't she? She's a former prostitute, so she knows her way around the boudoir.
Yeah, around the cock and balls. yeah, sorry,
but,
carry on.
Yeah, she's... No, I think, I mean, she's kind of like a trapped woman, isn't she? But she's super brave, but she doesn't think that anyone can get her out of it. Obviously, she's so scared of Raoul Silver. That, you know, even the thought that someone might be able to do something makes her get that sort of half fear. Sort of laugh, almost that laugh, sort of smile. She's shaking, and that fear sort of factor comes along, doesn't it? I mean, in the shower scene, she's great in that. But to be honest, she's not in it a huge amount of time, is she? Because we see her when the assassination attempt happens, very briefly, don't we?
Yeah.
We obviously see her at the casino, where we see the most of her, and get a bit of her backstory. And then obviously we see her in the shower on the boat. And then they go to the island, and then basically she's got the whiskey on her head, and she basically gets shot. So to be honest, we don't get a huge amount, but I think Bernice Marlowe is so good. I remember seeing Skyfall for the first time, coming out going, what was that character about? It was hardly in it.
You wasted her, man. There's no way that moment where she gets shot and it's like, oh, it was a waste of good scotch. To me, that was such a wrong move. And it was it was trying to be to show Bond being cold blooded, but it just made him look like a bit of a dick, if you ask me. Yeah. Like, I didn't like that sequence. And she should have, if she had to die at some point, fair game. But she should have lasted longer, I think. It was a weird sort of throwaway death.
Yeah. They filmed that scene, didn't they, where she was coming down an escalator with a couple of guards. But obviously that didn't make any difference. But anyway, strength of character. I suppose it's difficult because she's not in it for as long and she is a kept woman. She is kind of obviously scared of Silver, but she's just incredible in the role. And I think, I think the complexity behind her character is brilliant. Yeah. She might not be, you know, a CIA agent that can do everything, but just the nuances in her performance and the complexity of her background makes her a fascinating character, even though it's only for a brief amount of time.
Yeah, absolutely.
That's what I say.
All right, next up.
Vesper Lind. I mean...
Okay, right. Positive attributes. Yes, there are many. She is the one who would have got Bond to settle down had she not died. Like, she was the Tracy of the Daniel Craig era, and there is a lot to be said for that. I feel like women love Vesper as much as men do, and that's a hard thing to kind of get across, you know? It's like a lot of women might say somebody like, good night, is like, oh, thank goodnight, just being a bimbo, blah, blah, blah. And it's like, you know, that's a fair point. But I think with Vesper, women would say she's a strong character and they would probably get behind Vesper as much as we would, Chris, let's face it. So there's that. She's strong-willed. She's beautiful. Like I say, she would have got Bond to settle down had she not died. So there's a lot of ticks in that box, Chris. What are you thinking?
I mean, too many superlatives to describe her. I mean, like, she's clever as well. She's playing Bond the whole time.
Mm.
She obviously falls for him, and she does. But she's also playing him at the same time. And for Bond not to realise that, you've got to be one clever cookie. You've got to be able to pull the wool over Bond's eyes like that. She is a clever lady. She's smart. She's so gorgeous as well, like unbelievably gorgeous. And in terms of a character, alongside Tracy, it's probably the most in-depth character we've ever had. And that shower scene, man.
Yeah.
I mean, okay, let's look at the different moments. We've got the dialogue on the train when they first meet is second to none. It's pitch perfect. It's brilliant, aside from Amiga. Fuck that. But, you know, between them two, it's so good and so clever. We've got the whole Stephanie Broadchest thing. Excellent. We've got, like, dinner jacket. It's tailored.
I measured you up. She outwits him on the humor. Yeah. There. Great. Yeah. Love
so
it.
Good. So good. And then obviously we've got the actual casino scene. You were meant to make everyone else distracted. And obviously Bond was the one that was oogling her when she walked in. Mm. And then you've got everything that happens beyond that. And obviously the bit of the, I mean, there's just too much. She's just brilliant, basically. Just brilliant.
Yeah. All right. Last one.
Okay. I know you're a big, big fan of this last one. This for you is kind of like my Fiona Volpe. But here is, I mean, to be honest, I'm a big fan of her as well.
Yeah.
Electra King. Absolutely amazing. I love that thing that she's wearing at the end as well. She looks so gorgeous in that. Okay. So Electra King. What do we think of Electra King?
Goodness gracious me. When I think of Electra King, I feel like a grossly obese man in a donut shop. I just goodness gracious. I don't think it's when you let me just rewind my thoughts and get everything into gear. When she's all electro-kingy in The World Is Not Enough, she is so beautiful that it's just, I just don't even know. I mean, it would be, it would just, I don't even know where to begin. She's so beautiful.
And however, uses that power to her, uses she, that beauty to her power. Like
she does
so
yeah.
well.
Yeah. yeah. And she's, you got to give it to her. She's clever. She's very, you know, she gets the job done and she is the main villain. So she's, yeah. which is unique in the Bond series, isn't it? You know, it's, it you're is. Expecting it to be old Victor Zsokas, but it's, of course, her behind the scenes. So there is that great. So listen.
Yes.
At the risk of this becoming another hour on the end of the episode, right. I think if there were the three magic doors, like you said at the beginning, and it was like, okay, you can spend the night with either of these yeah. these delicious ladies and whatever. Yeah. I don't think I'd be able to choose. I think I would stumble. I just don't think I could choose. If it was a gun to the head, I think I'd lean toward Elektra, like purely from really? A physical standpoint. However,
that's funny. I know who I'd lean to.
But you'd go Severine, wouldn't you? Or would you go Vesper?
I'd probably go Vesper, I think.
Would you?
Yeah. See, oh, I don't know because they're all so nice.
Now you've changed my mind again. Shit. Anyway.
Right, let's forget that. We're not allowed to discuss that. Okay.
Yeah, we're going on strength of character, right? Okay. So let's just wipe that aside. Okay.
Yeah.
You know, a good wipe down is what we both need after this discussion, that's for sure.
Yep.
I think strength of character-wise, I feel like it's got to go to Vesper, really. She's the Tracy of her generation. She's multi-angled. She's not evil. She's just mixed up in some shit. Do you know what I mean?
Physically, she's multi-angled as well.
And she's got a cracking pair of norks on her. So there you go. What's your thoughts?
Well, just, I mean, I am going to agree with you. I just put a little bit towards Elektra King as well. She cuts off her own ears. She mutilates her own ear to for her own cause. You know, that's how dedicated she is.
Yeah.
To reach her end goal. Though, and when she says to Bond, you couldn't, you know, you'd miss me, that you know, she thinks she can overpower every man in the world. Yeah. She's that sort of confident. And she almost probably can. And she's great. And as a villainess, there's a lot going for her. So I just wanted to put that in there.
I'll tell you what, the one thing, though, Pierce does say that she's inexperienced in the old bedroom department, though, doesn't he? Do you remember? There is that. So,
oh, yeah, no, of course. Yeah, no, that's true. That's
but
true.
I don't believe it.
Let's cast her aside.
Yeah.
Well, she likes ice cubes, doesn't she? She's a bit like Largo. She likes the easy ice cubes. But no, I mean, okay, even when the three came out, I know it was going to be difficult, but Vesper, she's basically, if someone said to me, she's the best Bond girl character in the whole series that's ever been, I could not argue with that.
Yeah.
I like Tracy is obviously the only one that could come close, or vice versa if Tracy's the first. Vesper Lynn, the character's amazing. She's had more of an impact on Bond than any other aside from Tracy. The story is brilliant. Eva Green in the role is just amazing. The way the character's utilised is superb in terms of humour, in terms of like everything else it's done. That end bit with a lift as well, like you say, it just sticks in the memory, and you go through what Bond feels when you watch that. You're feeling exactly what he's feeling. Almost untouchable, I'd say.
And the extra points go to her because she's a Fleming character as well, so that's all the more special, isn't it? Yeah,
definitely.
But I tell you what, man, I've gone on an emotional journey in this round. I feel spent after that because it's
so do I.
Yeah, it really is.
It's funny, isn't it? Like, because we had some rounds where it was like, okay, you had one really easy to pick out straight away. You had others where no one stood out, but they were all okay, and you had to kind of pick and choose. Yeah. But when you get three bangers, like okay, Severine, she's so hot. I think the character, just in terms of the amount of time, kind of was a bit, made her character go down a bit in terms of screen time. But all three of them, like any door, whatever door you want, you know.
You're going to walk out with a smile on your face, aren't you? Either.
You certainly are. If you walk out.
I'll take them all. Lovely.
Let's just stay in there. Yeah, that's right. There we go. So just to let everyone know, so basically that is Bond Girl Battle, first round completed. So going through into round two is Solange, Paula Ivanova, Tracy, Melina Havelock, Solitaire, Fiona Volpe, Anya Massaba, Pussy Galore, Camille Montes, Domino, Waylin, Natalia Fedova Smirnova, Holly Goodhead, Miranda Frost, Zinya on the top, and Vesper Lynn. So those are the ones going through. So we've done a three-way battle, but from round two onwards is going to be, I was going to say mano a mano, but that doesn't really work, does it?
No.
Womano versus Womano.
Very nice.
It's going to be girl on girl. There we go. Bit of girl on girl.
There we go. So. That's what we like, bit of girl on girl. Lovely. Yeah.
That's what we could have done with the previous three. But anyway, so enough of that.
Good stuff. Cool. So next week, you can look forward to the next installment of The Music of Bond with Warren and John discussing From Russia with Love. That's going to be a lot of fun.
Wait.
Good stuff. One thing I suppose we should say is we made the announcement that we were going back to a weekly podcast. And the thing is with old Dan Gale and his documentaries is they are so demanding on the old time. I don't think there's any humanly way possible he'd be able to deliver
Definitely
one a month.
No.
So basically what we've said is just basically kick one out whenever you're ready kind of thing. So
yeah,
it's probably going to be every 2 to 3 months we'll get a Dan Gale
maybe,
documentary.
Maybe 10 weeks or something like that.
Something along those lines.
Yeah, yeah.
But, you know, when you look at the production quality and stuff of those things, they just take a long time to put together. So what we'll do in the off weeks is we will put in a little something for you to peruse. Like last week, we put in a location tour video and all that kind of stuff. So check your iTunes feed for that. So there'll be a little nugget on those off weeks. But as usual, you can expect me and you every 2 weeks, and then one in the middle, there'll be Warren and John, and then a little nugget on the one of the other weeks, or Dan if he's got something together.
So really looking forward, though, the week obviously of you From Russia with Love will be great. Really looking forward to hearing from John and Warren about that. But the week after that, we'll be back with the fan cast episode. So this is the third anniversary of James Bond Radio, which, to be honest, is pretty amazing as it is. But so what we're going to do, obviously, we've got the five names are chosen at this point in time. Obviously, we don't know them yet, but we'll be in touch and we'll get sorted.
We don't know them because we're recording it a week before the draw. So, yes.
We
so,
are.
Obviously, they have by now on this particular day, they have been drawn. So, anybody who won, make sure you send us your details and email address and all that kind of stuff. And we'll be in touch to set up the time for the call.
Excellent. Looking forward to that.
Absolutely.
Yes. So this has been basically the last goodbye of Sir Roger, isn't it?
Indeed.
Really?
Yes.
After all that.
It's
been amazing.
It's a sad but happy time. Don't be sad that it's over, Chris. Be happy that it happened is the motto, I think. But so moving on. Goodbye, Sir Roger. Hello, Sir
Indeed.
Timmy D. So it will be the year of Sir Timmy. It should
That's
be Sir
it.
Timmy, as far as I'm concerned. But
it will be Sir Timmy. It's got to be
it
Sir
will
Timmy
be.
At some point. Yeah,
damn
it has
right.
To be. Has to be. That's how it goes. Cool.
All right.
So
then,
there we go.
Until next time, I've been Tom Sears.
I've been Chris Wright.
And James Bond Radio will return. We'll see you then. Bye.
Bye.